The northeast corner of the most beautiful country in South Africa. You are live and you are watching Safari Live.
Ready?
Standing by.
Good afternoon again. My name is James Hendry. On camera today, Brian the Thumb Joubert. And Brian, a very special thumb today.
Indeed.
What is its significance?
It is the whale that the blue-bearded pirate fisherman was after.
The blue-bearded pirate fisherman, which was another thumb, correct, for our new viewers. Right, everybody, the narrative of the thumb continues to baffle and delight us as we drive through the wilderness on our live safaris. Welcome to it. For the next 3 hours, we will be in your company on the other vehicle, Hayden Turner, the inimitable Duke of Sydney, and he's being filmed by Jean Drey and his dreadlocks. Vile things that they are. Now, we've come into this area to try and find some lions. They were left somewhere around here this morning, I think with the little cubs, so I'm reticent to go wandering about on foot for too long. We're going to drive around here and just see if we can't find them again. I'm pretty sure we will do eventually, because lions don't tend to do a whole lot during the middle of the day. When I say you're on a live safari, if you happen to be a new viewer, that means you are on a live safari. So we can talk to you. We'd love to talk to you. We'd love to hear where you're from. We'd love to have any queries you have about the animals we're seeing, the landscape, where we are, and especially about potential travel to Africa. That's really important. Hashtag Safari Live is how you can talk to us on Twitter. Otherwise, you can speak to us on the email at questions@wildearth.tv. It's 26 degrees Celsius at the moment, which I think is around 78 degrees Fahrenheit, if I remember correctly. But there's a wind now, and it's changed. It was blowing from the northwest over there until probably about an hour ago. It switched. It's coming from the southeast. It's much cooler than those hot, what we call berg winds that come out of the northwest. So I think we're probably in for a bit of a front tomorrow. It's quite a nice feeling, actually, this cool breeze on us. I'd say that the winter has turned, and we're probably, certainly in this part of the country, we're starting to look up towards spring and the real business end of the dry season now. All right, welcome to it. We're going to do a little loop around here and we'll come back and see if we can find some further tracks of the lions. These I was wearing before we went live because it is very bright, isn't it, Brian?
It is.
So bright. Which my mummy always said to me, you may not talk to people with sunglasses on, James. It's very rude. So I don't. See that, Brian? Yes. Very important. Ah. I've been pulled out of my ear comms. Go again, Kirsten. Kirsten is directing today. Alright, let's go back across to Hayden Turner, the Duke of Sydney. He's managed to find you a cat already.
Thank you, Mr. James Hendry. Welcome, everyone, to a wonderful afternoon here in the Sabi Sands. And what a beautiful, beautiful day it is. There is a cool breeze, James is just mentioning. It's a beautiful afternoon, and we've come back to see our dear friend, Karula. And I have the wonderful Jean Drey on camera with me today, which is fantastic. Jean Drey and I haven't done a drive since about, November last year, which is great to be on drive with Jean Drey. So we've just pulled up here and we just wanted to see what was going on. Karula was just sort of up a little bit up the drainage line. The cubs were in another location and we just pulled up. We just gently sat here for a while. They stayed there for a while. And then the cubs started to play a little bit. And then Karula, they annoyed her a little bit, I think, and she had a little snarl at one of them. And then she's walked down to have a little bit more of a feed on that impala that she took yesterday afternoon. So she's really clever. She's such an incredible mother and such a wonderful, experienced leopard. We've watched her this morning and last night covering or caching that kill and covering it with dirt and leaves and not putting in the tree. It's there for her cubs to have a feed on as and when they need, and she's done an amazing job. So she's enjoying a little bit herself now, and we're just keeping an eye on it as well. It's great to be in her presence, of course, as I said before. But as you all know, I don't have to tell you about Karula. Many of you know more about Karula than I do, that's for sure. But for those of you who have just maybe joined us and could be on your first drive, welcome aboard. This is one of the most incredible wildlife experiences on the planet, to be on Safari Live. For us, that's for sure, and for everyone that's on board with us. Look at her. Beautiful girl. Completely relaxed, just looking up to see what's going on from us. And welcome aboard. This is a live broadcast from... I'm actually on Juma Game Reserve at the moment in Sabi Sands in South Africa, to the west of Kruger National Park, and what a great privilege it is for me to be here for this week. This morning we did a wonderful drive with schools in Australia. We had just under 1,000 students watching us this morning from about 30 different schools from all over the state, some really remote areas as well, which was a pretty awesome feeling to know that we were bringing these pictures similar to what we're looking at right now into classrooms all over the state of New South Wales in Australia. So we're on a normal or regular drive, for want of a better term. There's nothing such as a regular drive here on Safari Live. I always say, you know, we are visitors or ticket holders in the theatre of nature, really. And just here observing this beautiful leopard who is very famous and is a very successful mother, and she's doing a beautiful job raising her 7-month-old cubs, which they've been here all day. So we're elevated at the moment. We're probably about, I would say, 3 to 5 meters higher than her, and we're sort of on an angle at the moment. The vehicle's on an angle. It's a very, very thick wooded area. It's great. She's done exactly the right thing. Excuse me, please. And she's in a really greatly covered area. It's tricky for us, but fantastic for her. So we'll sit with her for a little bit longer and just watch and observe, and maybe the cubs will come up and have a bit of a play, and then we'll just see what happens. We might go off and leave her for a bit and then come back a bit later. It is quite warm. When we came here, she was sort of sprawled out over the cool sand, and then she decided to get up, as I said, when the cubs annoyed her a little bit. But we'll just sit with her and have a little bit more of a look, because it's also wonderful just to see her always. Just got a question from, I think it's Abhishek. Welcome aboard, and thank you for your your question. You want to know where Karula's cubs are? Well, just to the right, Jandre's just panning around there at the moment. They're sort of just up in the little cool nook or little sort of spot around that corner, that bend in the drainage line, and we can't see them from here. They have been messing about a little bit. But they're there around there, both of them safely tucked away, and Mum is definitely keeping a very, very careful eye as she eats. But also a careful ear. Incredible sense of hearing, leopards as well. And we saw her yesterday just sit up in this most magnificent position of you know, her ears perfectly attuned to the bush. And she wasn't sure what it was, and she sat up in such a manner that it was like she was ready to go and grab those cubs or take on whatever it was, but then she just settled back down. But ears and eyes and smell, all fantastic senses on these predators that they use on a daily basis, not just to hunt, but to look after themselves. As you all know, the leopard, you know, I always call the Rolls-Royce, or the sort of the pure embodiment of feline beauty and power, but they will run up a tree from definitely hyena and other smaller things, smaller than themselves as well, and that's quite hard to figure out. But they can be extremely bold and they can be extremely timid, and they're both characteristics that these beautiful cats have. I really do love just sitting and being in their presence, and I know you all do too. So welcome aboard, and great to have you with us. We don't really have any opportunity to get into a better position, folks, so we're just going to sit here and be for a bit. If the cubs do come out, I'll definitely try and reposition so Jandre can get a spot, better spot. But if you've got any questions, please send us a tweet or an email. It's hashtag Safari Live on Twitter, and it's questions at wildearth.tv for email. And please send us any questions you've got or comments. We'd love to hear from you. This is what it's all about. Interacting with you is what this is all about, the Safari Live Drives. And you are the biggest part of our team here. The animals and the habitat, we're very, very fortunate to be in, but you are such an important component. You're on the back of our vehicle, and anything you've got to ask us, or you want to make some comments, or you could help me out a little bit with some information, anything you know that you want to think I could know, a little snippet or tidbit of information about Karula, I'd love to hear from you. So she's really getting the most out of that. We've got a question from HK, and HK, it's a really good question. We had a similar one this morning, and your question is, since getting on board with Wild Earth in 2014, when I started and was very fortunate to do some drives then, and in a couple of the big cat weeks, I've seen some seasonal changes, and I go away and I come back and I really notice the difference. Sometimes when you're in the location a lot, it's like anywhere in your world, you don't see the changes dramatically. So when I do come back, I notice dramatic change in my own mind. And your question is, have I seen that dramatic change since I started, or in the seasons? I particularly have, HK, with this time that I've come back. It is very dry, but we know that winter is dry in South Africa and all across Southern Africa. It's a harsh time. Nature has adapted to it. All the animals adapted to it. All the plants have adapted to it. And it's tricky. But at the moment, there's an extended sort of dryness to it, and coupled with a couple of climatic conditions that are going on in the world right now, and you know, you can probably look up, I talked about it this morning, the effects of El Nino and what's predicted there in the future, and I think that has had an impact. It's definitely had an impact on the animals' behaviour. We're seeing a fair bit of elephant impact at the moment, and we all had a talk about it at breakfast this morning, and there's not much you can do, really. It is what it is, and the elephants have to eat, and they will impact as they impact. We will get rain at some point, and nature looks after that, but it's definitely something that's noticeable. So yes, HK, to answer your question, I have seen an considerable impact. But you know what? Nature will always find a way. Thank you very much for your question, and great to have you on board. So what we might do is just try and reposition, and whilst we're doing that, I'm going to cross over to the wonderful James Hendry and see what he's got up his sleeve. We'll be back with you right now.
Unfortunately, everybody, I have got absolutely nothing up my sleeve. I have either misinterpreted my information or been given bad information about where these lions were left. Now, I'm told they were between Aubrey's and Sandy Patch Road, that's where we are, just as the road bends towards Sydney's Dam, that's where we are. There are no tracks going either off the road here towards Aubrey's Road, so I'm just rather confused. We'll keep going down here and see what we can find. Now, there is, like I mentioned, the wind blowing. But there is also a real harshness about the light this afternoon, and that will dissipate, of course, as we go towards the sunset. But it can look very harsh, and I've always felt, especially in my travels around the villages of rural South Africa, that this time of the day, here we go, there's some tracks. They seem to be going straight back onto the road, though. I don't know, we'll just follow them to their zenith, and then we might have to go and look somewhere else. I've spent a lot of time in the villages outside these reserves, and they're very poor, and they're dusty, and they're wind-blown, and then suddenly at about 4 or 4:30, when the light changes and the softness comes and the heat breaks, they become the most amazingly attractive places, with kids playing in the streets and the ladies sort of sitting outside their homes talking to each other, one or two men going across to the illegal drinking houses that they have. And I'm always struck by how amazingly different the light can make a place look. And you will notice, as you just try and watch until the end of the drive, you will notice how this place becomes a golden, just a kind of golden picture of delight, as opposed to the slightly drought-riddled area it looks like now. This is Thomas in Pennsylvania. Last question from you, just while Brian is avoiding being killed by thorns. Thomas, you want to know about the local people here, and are there local people here, and are they, or indigenous people, is there any way to talk to them? Well, yes, absolutely, Thomas, there completely is. Do you mean for you or for anyone? We have a number of local people, Shangaan people, working with us. The most notable, who you will see quite frequently if you keep watching, is Herbert, who is our tracker and game scout. And he's a local Shangaan person with a wealth of traditional indigenous knowledge. And we had an incredible experience with him yesterday when we went tracking some lions on foot. And we found them and we viewed them on foot. And it was just a tremendous, tremendous experience. So, yes, Thomas is absolutely a way to speak to the local people here. Most of them, of course, speak English. And so there's a wealth of knowledge to be gained and a wealth of interesting cultural information that you can learn from the local people here. Now, these lions are not around here. But we will find them, people. Fear not. Do not be fearful. We will find them at some stage. There is a lovely shot of a starling sitting on this bush. Oh, you nasty little bird. There he is, he's back on the top there. He's a Cape Glossy starling, and he's, as I've said to many of you before, very closely related and very similar looking to a greater blue-eared glossy starling. But when he flew off there, you may have heard him, he went, and that has always reminded me of Cape Glossy starling. Cape Glossy starling, that's how I remember it. The greater blue-eared glossy starling has got a very nasal, and you can actually hear some flying above us now. And I always liken that to them saying, blue, blue, and that's how I know the difference between the Cape Glossy starling and the greater blue-eared glossy starling. Brian, did you know that?
No.
You do now, though. You are sore amazed, are you not? You can't believe it. I know you can't. Well, there you are.
Oh, thank you.
Yes. Now, I'm going to ask you to do something very difficult. Do you see that bird flying there? Can you try and train the camera on it? I know it's going to be difficult. I just want to see what it is, because I'm looking for the first Wahlberg's eagle of the season. That is not a Wahlberg's eagle. That is a white-backed vulture. Now, I know that it's but a speck on the horizon, but you can tell from the way it's flying. It's not a Wahlberg's, because it's not the right shape. It hasn't got a long enough tail, and its wings aren't sort of in a cross shape enough. Otherwise, it just flies like a white-backed vulture, so that's what it is. Not a Wahlberg's eagle, Brian. No, not yet. We will find it, though. Right, let's continue in our hunt for the lions. Right. Hayden is back with the same kitties, but this time some smaller versions. I will try and find the lions.
So we've moved from a big one to a little one. How beautiful. It's got up on cue there too. Walk straight through that beautiful dappled light. Mum is crunching through bones at the moment, and the little cubs are just walking right underneath us. Poor Jandre's been struggling to make this work. We did get that one little shot for you, but it's always a bit tricky, you know, with this. They're in the right spot for them, which is not always a great spot for us, and that's the way it works. We have to work around that, of course. And, you know, they're protected down there, and it's great for them, so that's the most important thing. And the little cubs are really safe there. But we've just been manoeuvring ourselves around this location to try and get a picture of that the cub, at least one cub for you. So from bigger to smaller, but I just was looking at the paw size. Just have a little look at that. I've just... put it up on my app, and it's a little bit easier to see there. It's sort of the difference in the shape of paw, and I was just looking at Karula's paws as she was holding on to that kill as she was eating. And this is the leopard paw here, with that very distinctive sort of W, upside down W at the back there, where the line track is very, very flat across the bottom of the track. And I just thought that was a bit interesting, just to give you a bit of a size or ratio comparison. This one, the actual front pads are really sort of nearly round and quite chunky, whereas these ones are a little bit more elongated on the line. And that is what James Hendry is looking for right as we speak. So I think we probably should get on the move and leave these guys a little bit, because they are moving around into very, very difficult positions. And, you know, we've had some beautiful sightings of Karula and the cubs in the last sort of 24 hours. She was up in this tree yesterday. So we'll just do a little tootle around a little bit, have a little scratch around here. We might come across some ellies and a few other species and see what we can find, and come back to this beautiful family later. Thank you very much, as always. And just have a little bit of a look around. I could drop you into somewhere in South Africa and then take you across blindfolded on a plane, not tell you. We could have gone around in a circle for all you know, and then drop you in a place in Australia, and you could probably think you're on the same continent. It's very, very similar in its vegetation in places, not always, but obviously South Africa and Australia, if you get down to the nitty-gritty, incredibly diversely different. But wow, we're in a country right now that is classified as mega diverse. I mean, South Africa is one of the most amazing places on the planet. There's no doubt about it. And I love this country so much. I love it as much as Australia. But the wildlife is very, very different. Australia got all the marsupials, incredibly unique creatures that have got a very, very unique way of reproduction, you know, giving birth to barely developed young and then growing them and nurturing them in a pouch where they will suckle in a pouch, and most of the mammals do that. Whereas over here, we don't have any marsupials, and Australia actually doesn't have any natural herbivore or grazing animals, or ungulates for that matter, hoofed animals. We don't have an indigenous hoofed animal in Australia. The animals that we do have there that have hooves have all been introduced since 1888, and that was horses, cows, sheep, goats, pigs, camels, and all those other species. And they do have an impact on the environment, that's for sure. So as soon as you unbalance an environment with a non-indigenous species, you start to get issues, you start to get competition, you start to get particularly when you introduce a species, whether it be a mammal or anything else, it may not have a natural predator, and that's when the balance goes completely out of whack. So that's happened a lot in Australia, but you know, there's some really, really great organisations working tirelessly to try and get on top of things like that. Not always easy, that's for sure, but to get back to your question, James, the wildlife. And I think as a kid, I think anywhere in the world, James, that you are, you always look abroad, don't you? You get complacent with what you've got at home. After being away for 25 years from Australia, I actually have gone back to Australia with a completely new lease of life on the wildlife we've got there. It looked like one of my favourite mammals droppings on the ground there, Gendre. I just noticed something I'm just keeping an eye out for. We'll keep everyone on the back of the vehicle in suspense, because I do feel like we may be upon them somewhere. But James, yeah, it's the animals. And I always just used to lie in front of the television as a kid, absolutely in awe of Africa. But I, as I said, I've got a newfound love of Australian wildlife. And it's been great. It's been great, particularly seeing it through my son and my wife's eyes as well, because my wife is originally, she's from Zimbabwe, and my little boy was born in the United Kingdom, so it's been great to show them all the fantastic Australian animals through their eyes as well, and rediscover them. Laura just asked a question, and hello Laura, welcome aboard, thank you very much for being with us today, asking me about Australian koalas, well koalas, sorry, in Australia. There's definitely a problem. You're asking if they are losing, or the numbers are depleting because of habitat loss. Absolutely it is, it always is. Habitat loss is probably one of the biggest impacts on the planet, and fragmentation. As human populations become greater, they fragment corridors for animals to move. It happens all over the world, and that's one of the things we really strive to improve, I think, is one of the best things I could say. But the habitat loss is one thing, but there's also, unfortunately, a couple of diseases that are transmitted between koalas that have been a problem. They've been doing a lot of research on that. Koala populations in some areas, Laura, are stable, and then in other areas not so. So, you know, we always make sure that we have fantastic insight into that, lots of great research, lots of fantastic universities and zoos in Australia, including Taronga Zoo, where I work now, doing amazing work to make sure koalas, one of those iconic, magnificent species that we have there, has a future. That's very important. But thank you very much for the question, Laura. Never did I think I'd be sitting here in Africa driving around answering questions about koalas. So that's brilliant. Thank you so much. We're just having a little look along here. I just want to go up to see if there's any ellies around one of the permanent water points up here, via Telepan. You never know. It's more luck of the draw. Elephants come and drink at irregular and regular times. It just depends on the herd and so on, but and the matriarch. But we'll just toodle along here and have a little bit of a look. But I think we should go back to James and get a bit of an update from him, because I'm really, really keen to find these lions. So we'll see you just now.
He certainly is very keen to find these lions, everyone, but he's failing dismally at this stage. Anyway, we're going to just do a little loop around this area, and then we're probably going to see what else we can see. It's been quite a warm day, so definitely worth going towards the waterholes and seeing if there aren't any elephants around the place. And apparently they were around here somewhere. Oh well. Never mind, we will find them. Better to look at them in the evening light than this light, don't you think, Brian? Yes. Yes, saving them for later. Building everyone's expectations and then just releasing them at the end, you know? looking into the undergrowth here. You can easily drive past a pride of lions, of course, in this kind of vegetation, because they don't like to lie out in the sun on a hot day. So they could easily be in the deep shade somewhere, watching us drive up and down the road, thinking, what a bunch of gormless idiots. Do you think that's what they're thinking, Brian?
Most likely.
Most likely, what a bunch of gormless idiots. Okay, what we'll do now is just pop up the road here to Sydney's Dam, see if they haven't decided that they'd like to have a drink there and lie next to the waters. I nearly said crystalline waters. Of course, that would have been a blatant untruth, for they are no more crystalline than the waters of Biffles Hook Dam, perhaps. All right. Taxon's getting mobile, so we're just going to ask him. Afternoon, no sightings updates so far. Can't relocate on the Nkumas. Sorry, Kirsten, you're going to have to go with the game. Same place, Debbie in Vancouver, nice one from you about the signs of spring. Now, first sign of spring for me is not actually the Walbergs, it's the knobthorn flowers. The knobthorns have already started putting out one or two flowers, long sort of rachises of sweet-smelling, pale honey-yellowed flowers. And they are around at the moment, so that's kind of the first sign of the heat. No lions there, but there are some quite interesting guinea fowl to the left of us, and some impala. There we are. One must stop for impala at least once a day. It is a rule. And one should always stop for guinea fowl because they're very amusing to look at. There's such a kind of incongruous sort of shape. They can fly pretty well, they run incredibly fast, and they're rather iconic as ground-dwelling birds out here. I remember once when I was a child, we went on a little bush trip with some family friends, and I saw these things doing precisely what they're doing here. I was probably about 12, and filled with a sense of my own brilliance, speed, athleticism, and general magnificence, and I bet that I could catch one on foot. And this bet, of course, was taken up by the much wiser and older family friend, much the consternation of my father. And I went haring after one of these things, not realizing that they can actually fly. And I scattered the entire flock, of course. And, well, I was 20 rand the poorer. Now, 20 rand back then, well, that was millions of rands now, wasn't it, Brian? Yeah, back in 1927. And that is the helmeted guinea fowl. One of two species of guinea fowl that we find, but only one that we find here. You do get the other one, the crested guinea fowl, in the northern reaches of the Kruger Park, but not round here. Righty, they're trying to find a couple of seeds to eat, the last grass seeds now. Well, interestingly, but before we move on, if the rain was to come, like the rain did come a little while, about 3 or 4 weeks ago, and there was a flush of green, that green comes largely from a seedbed that is very extensive. So if you are a bird like this and you like to eat seeds, they'll also eat insects and probably the odd fruit. If you scrabble around in the sand enough, you will find grass seeds, and I think that's probably what they're trying to find now. Even though it looks like it's pretty barren and that there's not much there, there are probably quite a few seeds, and were you to just sprinkle some water there, you'd find grass immediately springing out of this very sodic or nutrient-rich soil. Right, that's enough of the guinea fowl. Don't you think, Brian? They are quite nice. Have you ever eaten a guinea fowl?
I haven't.
It's disgusting. Yeah. It's not that gamey. It's a bit like eating a ball of string. Yeah. Ball of cotton. Same consistency as dental floss, really. And it's always amused me at the lodges that I've worked, everyone, where they've served guinea fowl as a kind of local delicacy, you know, a local wild game meat. And to describe, I feel, the taste of guinea fowl as a delicacy is to do an injustice to delicacies around the world. It is it's very stringy. It tastes of generally whatever you cook it with. And that, to me, is the great test of whether something is worth eating or not, whether it tastes more of what you cook it with or of its own flavor. And I think you find that with a lot of game animals and game birds, because they spend a lot of time using their muscles, they're quite hard. They're not sort of the kempt or kept farm animals. And we're going to go down the fire break here. Oh, there's a warthog. It doesn't bode well for lions, but it does bode well for the warthog. We'll just get into a position where we can see them, and I think this is probably our sounder that has been around here since these little piglets were born. But they seem to have lost a few, Brian. Do you remember there was five of them? Do you think the others have gone the way of all flesh?
Been
devoured, suffered the claws and teeth of outrageous lions. Do you like my Shakespearean reference there, Brian? It was, wasn't it? Yes. It was completely inappropriate, but I mean, you know. If you say things with a pompous enough accent, people believe them to be true. Yes, a sow and two piglets. You know what I think? I actually don't know that they have. I think the sounder may have just split up. There used to be another sow with three piglets, if I'm not mistaken. And maybe the others have either... They might have been eaten, but I wonder if they haven't just moved on. Now, what's interesting, if you look at these warthogs, you read in any textbook you like, they'll tell you that warthogs suffer the worst when there's a drought. Well, those warthogs look to be in pretty good nick to me. You can easily see when a warthog is not in a good way. And those ones are in a very fine way. But we were as I was explaining, I think it was yesterday, I was driving back from Hoedspruit on Saturday afternoon. And just outside one of the reserves there, the warthogs have all escaped. And they're eating on the road verge, which isn't good grass, but it's the only grass available to them, and they look horrendous. So they are really struggling from the drought. But the ones here, interestingly, in the open system that is the Kruger Park, these guys seem to be doing fine. And I think you'll find that has a lot to do with the fact that there's a... I mean, I hesitate to say balance, but there's a bit more of an equilibrium about the ecology in an open system than there would be on a piece of land that has to be actively managed all the time by the landowners. They don't like us very much, do they, Brian? It's because we spoke about them being eaten. Now, quite unlike guinea fowl, everybody, warthogs are delicious to eat. Have you eaten warthog, Brian?
I haven't.
That you would enjoy. Very tender. I'm just scanning the bush behind them, and the off chance there isn't, they're not about to step into a lion, which is what happened when we found them on foot yesterday. A whole sounder of warthogs came walking past them, and two of the lions went after them. And I think one of the boars turned and actually gave one of the lions a bit of a smack, and they gave up. Right, let's carry on. And of course, the ultimate delicacy that people will try and con you into eating out here and describe it as a delicacy is the Mopani worm. It's a caterpillar, It is edible, but I mean, coriander is edible, Brussels sprouts are edible. What else is edible, Brian? Kidneys and liver are edible. Various things are edible but are not necessarily considered delicacies. And the Mapani were an important part of the local diet because of the lack of protein in the diet. But a delicacy it is most assuredly not. In fact, I can't think of one real South African delicacy. And if we include the rusk, for example, have you got a rusk with you? Can I show everybody a rusk? That, everybody, is a rusk. Now, this in South Africa is considered food. In most parts of the world, this is considered a weapon. Or a building material. Right, on that note, we're going to keep looking for the lions and head back across to Hayden and get an update from him.
James Hendry, isn't he wonderful? Oh, the man can talk about anything. I love that. It's fantastic. And James, it's been an absolute pleasure to see James again. That's for sure. And go and drive with him. But look what we've come across. One of my favourites. And Jandre was just saying to me that they haven't seen a lot of buffalo of late. And we just turned around the corner here and there's all these bachelor, it's a bachelor herd. Some very, very big boys in there. And they're all taking it very easy, relaxing. Just behind them is a little water point, a permanent water point, which they've all, I think, had a bit of a crack on and just now ruminating. Now, many of you know what ruminating is, but for those of you that may not, we're looking at a ruminant, a group of very, very successful, probably the most successful group of hoofed animals that there are, animals that have the ability to regurgitate their food and chew it over again and get incredible sort of nutrition and efficiency out of that cellulose, that plant matter, which is very hard to digest. So through certain bacteria that they have in their stomach and the process of fermentation, it breaks down into a carbohydrate that they can absorb as energy. But you can see, I think, that one that Jandre's got right in shot there is ruminating. You see it chewing its cud. You probably see, I mentioned it yesterday, but you might see just even in your own local countryside cows ruminating as they're lying down or even standing. So that's what many of them are doing right now, and completely relaxed with us just to the left of that individual that Jandre's got in shot there. There's a couple just rolled over on their side and are so relaxed there, which is always a great way to view wildlife. You know, obviously trying to get within the distance that we can see them well, but of course trying not to change their behavior or when we come into their environment to just let them be. And we approach nice and quietly, slowly approach them, and they've just stayed exactly where they are. So they have a massive set of cheek teeth and this sort of broad incisor row that, and it coupled with that prehensile tongue, it allows them to really gather bundles of grass which you need with each bite. And this is one of the things that these guys are doing really well at. They can eat the coarse grass, they can eat the grass that isn't so sweet. So when grass is pretty scarce or unpalatable, these guys can cope with that. Now, they do love water, that's the other thing. They will like to try and drink at least once a day, and that's why they're just hanging near this water point right now. But, you know, in times that are tough as well, they're predominantly grazers, but they will browse. I've seen them browsing on vegetation a lot of times. I've got red-billed oxpeckers on there. A couple of their faces just slightly annoying. That one just over there, just slightly annoying them, sitting on the back of them at the moment. Couple just flying around their faces and ears. So this wind has picked up, folks. It's very cool, and we will talk a little bit about the wind now as well. The wind is blowing, and That has makes a tendency to for animals, particularly the hoofed animals. I don't know, I've picked up over years and years of watching, and I know many others have as well. When it's windy like this, they have a tendency to get into the cover a little bit, because you know what it's like when you're in a wind or you're on a bicycle or having the winds going through your ears, past your ears, it's very hard to hear. And I've always thought that, you know, they get into a bit of a more protected area to get out of that wind, and they can hear a little bit better. But the buffalo, with the strength of numbers that they have, there's not going to be anything really that's going to give them a worry. What have we got? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 individuals there. Yeah, that's just short of a pretty serious team. that is a team to be reckoned with, so they have no worries. They're happy just to be out in the open. There's 26 degrees Celsius and about 78 Fahrenheit at the moment, and that, as Jandre was just saying, it's an unusually warm day at the moment. It is really, really hot, and they're just doing what they do, ruminating, and we might just leave them be and move on. I'm not going to drive past them, because if I drive past them, I'm going to disturb them, so I'm going to reverse out of here. But thank you very, very much, Mr. Buffaloes. They're really cool. I love buffalo. I really enjoy them. I just think they're really, really cool. Now, just had a really, thank you very much, Buffs. Just had a really interesting question from Teresa in Virginia Beach. Just while I reverse, Teresa, I'll just get out of these Buffs zone so we don't disturb them. And from Virginia Beach, Teresa, welcome aboard, great to have you. And you'd like to discuss giraffe vocalizations. Well, wow, it's an interesting one. It's a very interesting one. There's a lot of research going on, Teresa, at the moment about whether giraffes make any form of sound that is in a frequency that's inaudible to our ears. There's a lot of research going on. There's research projects going on in Africa and in captivity in zoos at the moment around the world. And people are thinking that they do actually make some sound that we don't hear. But to your question about vocalizations that we can hear, I have only ever really heard, and after I've looked up, I've worked with giraffe for, gosh, nearly 30 years. No, not nearly 30, 25, 20 years-ish. Many years in captivity and then in the wild, and I still have a very, very big part in working with giraffe conservation, and particularly with a very good friend of mine, Dr. Julian Fennessy, who heads up with his wonderful wife, Steph Fennessy, in Namibia, the world's leading giraffe organization or research organization called the Giraffe Conservation Foundation. Now, I work on that team for the simple reason I'm really passionate about giraffes. I love them. I think they're one of the most incredible animals. And Julian has been telling me there's some research papers coming out in the next probably month that is going to change the whole way that we look at giraffe and think about giraffe. That's the first exciting thing. He's also got some students working with him and through him on giraffe vocalizations. But I've only ever heard giraffe make a sort of roaring or a grunting sound. And what it correlates with, whether it was danger or whether it was just coughing, or the like, or some sort of physiological noise that they were making, I'm not sure, but it's like a roaring or a grunting sound. It's like someone clearing their throat in a way, and that's the only time I've ever heard them make a sound. I hand-reared a giraffe in a zoo about 23 years ago even, and it never made a sound that I could hear. So we're not sure, the jury's out a little bit there, and I think one of the interesting things that comes out of this, I'll just sort of round up with it for you, is that everyone thinks giraffe are okay. They just think that, you know, oh yeah, giraffe are okay, we see them in all the pictures and everything. The status of giraffe in Africa, on the continent, is actually very, very tricky at the moment. There's a lot of habitat loss, there's a lot of fragmentation. There, you've probably heard of something called the IUCN Red List, which is the International Union for Conservation of Nature. They have a red list of all creatures on that are threatened, and it goes from least concern, which is animals they don't have to worry about. Well, not worry about, but they're of least concern. The numbers are just stable, up to critical, up to endangered, up to, you know, the worst, of course, which is extinct. And two giraffes have been put onto the endangered species list. One is in Niger, that is the giraffe that occurs up there, and then the Rothschild giraffe as well. So it's very, very important. That's also known as the Baringo giraffe. If you do want any more information on this, you can go onto that website, this giraffeconservation.org, and pick up. There's loads and loads of resources there. I highly recommend it. If you're passionate about giraffes, it'll answer many a question, and it's got a great newsletter you can subscribe to. It's one of those animals that's a silent worry at the moment. Everyone thinks there's loads of them left, but I tell you what, latest counts and research has shown that there's approximately just over 90,000 giraffe left in Africa. Much different numbers than people thought. It's, you know, it's something we have to keep an eye on, and it's got a lot to do with, we have to work forward with governments, and I have to take my hat off to Niger, or however you want to pronounce it, government. They had about 50 of their giraffe, their subspecies in Niger, and the government made an absolutely a full-on commitment to repopulating that giraffe, and there's now about 500 of them. So that's a really great success story, and hopefully we're going to have more of them. But great question. Thank you very, very much, Teresa. And you know how passionate I am about my giraffe. It's something we always have to keep our eye on, and as we do all species. So, we're going to move on now. Jandre and I were just having a talk about Buffelsoek Dam again. We're just going to have a little drive up there. There is a little bit of water in it. It's pretty rank, the water, but we might see some elephants bathing up there or something, because it seems to be very quiet around, and this wind, we'll just see what we can come up with. But let's cross over to James and get an update from him, and I'll come back to you just now.
Hello everybody, we had another 758 confusing messages about where the lions were left. Nobody seems to have any consensus, so we're leaving. And we'll come back here, I think, as the sun goes down, it gets a little bit cooler, maybe they'll become mobile, they'll stick their heads out of the thick bush, and they'll walk around a bit, and then maybe we'll be able to find them. But I'm afraid that's it for now. So we are going to head along in an easterly direction towards the eastern fringes of the reserve. We'll give you a view of the clouds building off to the southeast and see what other wonders this wilderness has to give us. It's a very oddly chilly wind. A viewer called Easy Peasy. Hello, Easy Peasy. Let me just compose myself briefly. Nice to hear from you. I'm not sure if we've heard from you before, Easy Peasy, but it is very good to hear from you now, Easy Peasy. Do tell us where you're calling from. I want to know about indigenous species versus exotics. Are all the species in the Kruger indigenous, or have some been reintroduced? All of the species that are occurred here, bar the exotics, that plant species that have come down the rivers from time to time out of the communities and the farmlands to the west of the park, everything else is indigenous, but there are, so all the mammals are indigenous, but there have been localized reintroductions of species that have gone locally extinct. For example, the white rhino White rhino and black rhino, which went locally extinct or almost locally extinct in this area, that were repopulated from Natal or KwaZulu, which is down in the sort of east coast regions of South Africa, but they were indigenous here originally. I thought I saw an aminal there, Brian. It may not have been an aminal though, it may have been a stick. A marula stick? Yeah, a good stick to see. Yeah, I think it was a marula stick, everybody. Sorry about that. So easy peasy, none of the animal mammals or birds that you see here are introduced. There is a species of snail that Steph and Jamie discovered called a banded snail. That's exotic. We're not entirely sure where it comes from. Well, I'm not. I think it's a South American species. There's the animal that I saw. It's the nyala. It's charging us, Brian, you see? It's in full charge. Here it is, everybody. That's what I saw. It wasn't a stick after all. My eyes, aging as they are, did not deceive me. And what is it eating? Is it eating those dry leaves? Some greeny ones. Also looks in pretty good nick. Very fine muscle definition about the shoulder. They are such beautiful antelope. Oh, and maybe you heard there in the background the call of the three-streaked chagra. It's now called the brown-crowned chagra, sorry. There we are, a male nyala. It's quite satisfying saying it like that, Brian. You should try it. You see? It is satisfying, isn't it? Yes. Everybody, try it. Two words out here. Well, there are a few. Sisyphus being one of them. Sisyphus. Sisyphus. It just feels good. And nyala. One goes mad if one sits in the sun and looks for lions too long. One's madness is encouraged, of course, by Brian. He fuels it slightly. I mean, how many other people do you know who have a narrative going with their thumbs? Brian, how many pictures did that one very dedicated thumb viewer taken? 630 pictures of Brian's thumb. And all of them unique designs.
Pretty much.
I'm astounded. And let's just quickly look in here, mainly because it's always good to have a stretch, everybody. So jump out the car, stretch your legs, and come and have a look over here. This is where our sounder of warthogs used to live, the same one that we were talking about. Now, I don't know why they left here. Can you hear me, Brian? But there's definitely no fresh activity here. But they used to squeeze about, what was it? They used to squeeze about 8 warthogs into this hole. But it doesn't look like there's any fresh activity there. That said, there are flies. And they are those flies that are associated with aardvark. Just kidding. Nothing in there. It's a really deep hole. You can't see the bottom of it. I don't know why they left it. It looks like such a good spot. And quite close to what you might think. I'm breaking up. I've turned my back to you. Better. So quite contrary to what you might think, everyone, warthogs will abscond from their burrows if they're threatened. They don't stay in there unless the predator is right on top of the mound, in which case they will. Otherwise, they just disappear. And so if we were to go up towards there and they were in there, they'd come out and run away. Hello, Nina from Spain. We're often asked about the danger of our jobs. You want to know what the most dangerous situation I've ever been in is while walking in the bush. Walking or any situation. Kirsten? Any situation, right, not just walking. Right, the most dangerous situation I've ever been in is a very simple answer. It was when we were watching some wild dogs, and many of you would have heard this story before. The wild dogs chased a leopard up a tree like this, and then the leopard came down and ran away and went up another tree like this, and that happened sort of 5 or 6 times, and then eventually it went into a kind of real thicket. The leopard ran into a thicket, chased by the wild dogs, and we kind of weaved our way through and around, and eventually we saw them. And just underneath a tree, pinned underneath a tree like... 1 second. Like this. Like the sort of fallen branch there. You see that fallen branch there? The leopard had been pinned right underneath there by the three wild dogs, and he was trying to fight back, but the dogs let him go as we came around the corner, because they got a fright from us. And the leopard looked at us and he just came straight at the car. He jumped onto the bonnet. Now, why he stopped there and didn't jump back or didn't come onto the people at the back of the car, I don't know, but he could have killed three or four people, I guess, before we could even have breathed. He didn't do that. He fell off the car, and the dogs came up, and they were all so close that I couldn't see over the front of the vehicle. I didn't know where they were, and the tracker, it was a wonderful tracker and brilliant animal behaviorist, said that he's going to come again, you've got to move. And I couldn't, because we'd backed up onto a termite mound. So I reversed a little bit, but I couldn't go any further. And sure as nuts, the leopard came round and he came at my door. And we didn't have a door in those cars. There was just an opening. So my legs were exposed. So I swung the car and it went up the side of the termite mound. Now, the greatest danger that we faced there was that I actually nearly turned the car over with the guests in it. And that would have been catastrophic. Tracker said, stop, stop, stop. So I stopped the car. The leopard jumped onto the bonnet again. And then he mauled the tracker's seat. There was a seat on the front there, but we used to put the trackers in the back when we went into a predator sighting. And as he fell off, a little gap between the dogs opened and we just drove out and we didn't stop. So that was the most dangerous situation I've ever been in. It's possible that I've been in more dangerous situations and just not realized it, but that's the most dangerous situation that I've realized I've been in. It's not common though. So you mustn't think that if you're thinking of traveling out here that you're going to have a sort of Red Bull extreme sporting experience. It's not going to be dangerous, it's adventurous to a certain extent, but it most certainly is not a dangerous thing to do. Alright, let's go and get an update from Hayden. I'm going to head a little bit faster along here and see if we can't find our white-faced owls.
Well, folks, just still scratching around. Jandre and I have really noticed a sort of not lack of mammals, but just the quietness at the moment. And we do put it down to the wind. It's all very quiet, and that's fine. That's the way things are. There's a lot of elephant activity and a lot of tracks around, spore around of different species. But what I did see back down there before further was the droppings of giraffe, and it looked like, well, here's some more here right in front of us. So we're just going to keep sort of having a little bit of a look down here. We think there could be possibly giraffe down in here somewhere. And we just want to just keep having a bit of a look around, because I'd love to find a giraffe. I haven't seen a giraffe since I've been here. I'm just asking control folks just to repeat the the little girl's name. I just want to hear that name again, please, Control. Sabrina, fantastic. Sabrina, thank you very much for joining us today, matey. Great to have you on board. And you just said...
Right, sorry about that, everybody. We've just put our jerseys on. That wind is so very strong indeed. I'm just listening to the Game Drive radio. Somebody's trying to explain what the names are of those two cubs that used to be known as G and C. Remember that? Remember that, Brian, the good old days?
Oh, really good old days.
The good old days. It's Hosanna. Hosanna as in small chief, not Hosanna as in praise the Lord. Just clearing that up for everybody. Now, I want to see if our little white-faced owls are around. But there seems to be a... very large white vehicle heading towards us at some speed. But they have very kindly moved off for us, so we shall lift our hats in respectfulness, aye, and greet them fondly. And I'm pretty sure those are contractors who've been working on some of the private lodges here at Biffleshook. Now, the little tree with our white-faced owls is just down here, and I watched the most amazing video, which I told many of you about yesterday, because I couldn't believe that white-faced owls could look so completely different. And I'll show you what I mean with any luck. Now, it's this tree coming up on our right-hand side. Gracie, good afternoon to you. I'm going to answer your question right now. I'm just going to look in this tree first. This is where the owls were, and they stayed here for a number of days. You see any of them? No, I don't think they're there anymore. Let me just go a little bit forward. No. They've moved. Sorry about that. I'm just going to get a quick update on the radio. Gracie, I will answer your question. Apparently Mvula has been seen. Sorry, I'm just trying to listen to what on earth is going on. Okay. Never mind, I'll get back to them. Gracie, you say, have we seen a pip bird, you said, since we last saw them a few days ago, and do I still like to say pipit? Gracie, I love to say pipit. It's my favorite word out here at the moment, pipit. It's right up there with nyala. And what was the other one? Sisyphus. A pipit, everybody, is a bird that you find in the clearings, and we find them on the airstrip at Arethusa. So, Gracie, yes, pipit. I still like to say it. It's a wonderful word, pipit. Mike, come in. Going to quickly try and find out where that sighting is. Okay, in the meantime, let's go back across to Hayden and get an update from him. We're just at Biffleshook Dam now. We might see you there.
Well, sorry about that, folks. We went through a little, what we call a black spot there. It happens a bit. Sometimes we lose a bit of signal, and I know many of you that have been with us for some time understand that. And if you're a new Safari Live viewer, Just got a couple of buffalo here again, which we might just get a little couple of beautiful pictures of because it's a nice big bull. Just reverse up for Gendre here. They're just off in the area there. I don't know if that's any good, Gendre. Is that okay? Yeah, they're a bit behind a bit of vegetation, but a couple of nice big bulls again. Just grazing through this area. And as we said, many animals in this at this time in this wind have just gone into the vegetation. So we did have that little black spot where we just dropped out a signal, and you know, that does happen, so apologies about that. Now back to Sabrina. Sabrina, hi, I'm back. Great to have you with us, that's the first thing. Most importantly, you are wonderful to be on board. 12 years of age, I hope you're very, very well. 12 years young, I should say. And if your favorite animal's giraffes, well, we have something very big in common there, my friend. And one of the things I would love to know a little bit more about, your message to us was that you spent the summer working with a baby giraffe. I'd really like to know more about that. Was it at a zoo? I don't know where it was, but I'd love to know a bit more. If you can send us a bit more information. But your question was, it was licking you a lot. Is that natural? Well, any animal that does lick a human a lot, particularly when it's a hoofed animal, it's normally got a lot to do with the salt on your skin, Sabrina. And it does happen. It does happen. There's no doubt about that. I've just tried to stop in a spot for Gendre to get a nice little picture of a Nyala, but as I'm rolling forward, the Nyala's walking the other direction. There we go. Gorgeous antelope. Beautiful, just looking around there. Not sure if you can see if I go down a little bit further. Just through there, staring at us. Look at that beautiful face. Gorgeous antelope. There's a male just off to the right, but he's in a bit of a thicket. But Sabrina, I think I would really like to know a little bit more about your story. So if you could send us a little bit more information, the directors can feed that through to me and I can ask you some questions, because that sounds like an incredible experience, Sabrina, to do that. Look at this beautiful female Nyala. I love that walk. I love how they just sort of do that head back and forth, gently walking through. She's come out into the open for us. How beautiful. Probably not for us, but one would like to think sometimes. Gorgeous, those stripes just breaking up the body shape there. Beautiful adaptation, beautiful little bit of camouflage. We nearly missed her as we drove past, and you can see how she just disappears into that vegetation when she goes past there. Very similar stripes to the kudu. Those stripes are a unique stripe pattern. You can see how skittish she is though in this wind. It's very interesting. Ears going around 180 degrees, trying to figure out if there's any danger ahead. Walking through there gently. Beautiful. We will just carry on now. That was a nice little interlude. I love Nyala. So Sabrina, what an interesting moment you must have had, and I would love to know more. So tell us a little bit more about it. Your question, as I said, if an animal does lick your skin, or if it's a hoofed animal particularly, it's normally got a lot to do with the salt on our skin. We have a certain amount of salt in our sweat, and that does happen. But wow, if you've also been with a baby giraffe, I hand-reared a baby giraffe, so we've got another thing in common, buddy. That's great to hear. But there's giraffe droppings all around here. We've got a question from Susan in the Netherlands. Fantastic, Susan. Great to have you on board. I'm not sure how you're doing in the Olympics, but I haven't been watching. But I know that you guys go out in force to support your sporting teams in the wonderful fluorescent orange. So I hope you're doing well. Your question is, do giraffe bond with humans in captivity? Look, one would like to think so. Giraffes aren't, you know, look, I love them, but I have to be completely honest with you, if you want to compare them to like an elephant or something like that, they're not quite as probably reactive. They're a bit chilled, the old giraffe. They really do just sort of go about their ways. And when I hand-reared that giraffe, it definitely knew who I was. We're seeing some beautiful antelope here. I'm coming back to you, Susan, I promise you, but I just wanted to see, we saw some young female of this species yesterday, and here is a beautiful bull. Beautiful bull. A water buck. Really gorgeous animal. Super. Really, really beautiful example of an antelope that we don't see a lot of, but we do see the females quite often. And this guy is a great example of a male. Those beautiful, beautiful ridged horns. Super, super creature. So only the males have horns on this particular species. And the funny thing is about their name, I don't think in my life of seeing water buck I've ever seen one in the water. They seldom swim, they prefer dry land, but they like to be around water, and they need to drink more regularly than most other hoofed animals I know of. So it's a very interesting thing about, I think their name is about more how they drink rather than seeing them in the water themselves. Beautiful, absolutely beautiful. They do have fierce battles with each other, these guys. You can see how sharp those horns are. Very, very beautiful, beautiful animal. And they're found sort of throughout a little bit of southern Africa. They sort of go up into Zambia and then Tanzania, Kenya, across the middle of Central Africa, and then there's a bit of a gap in that real equatorial rainforest area. Then he's just heard something there. Isn't that a beautiful, beautiful sight? Alert. Oh, that's stunning, stunning animal. Then they go right across into West Africa as well, I've seen them. There's two different species. There's the one called the common waterbuck, or the one we're seeing now, and there's another one called the Defassa waterbuck, which is a little bit more up into East Africa and West Africa. But they don't often stick around for this long, so it's really lovely to see this beautiful bull. And they've got a bit of a sort of slow gait. Got a lovely comment from Orishia, who says she loves the heart-shaped nose of the waterbuck, and I totally agree with you, Orishia. And I also have to show you the other end, which has a wonderful, wonderful marking on it as well. That quintessentially waterbuck mark of the ring around the hindquarters there, which is one of those things that all the common waterbuck have. Why it's there? Well, I'm not really sure. I'm not really sure on that one. I suppose we can interpret it as whichever way we want. But what a lovely, lovely little encounter with that. So I was back with Susan about do giraffe bond with humans. Look, this giraffe definitely knew that myself and a few other keepers that I worked with in Taronga Zoo at the time that were doing this with me, or all of us as a team, hand-rearing this beautiful giraffe, who was rejected by his mum for some reason, which we still don't know why, but we did hand-rear this animal, and his name was Nagani. And he used to, when you turn up, he'd get really excited and he'd be really playful and everything, but as they get older, I'm sure, you know, we would love to think that a lot of the animals that we hand rear in captivity or whatever, see us as an old pal. But, you know, a lot of the time it'll be completely food orientated, and we have to be completely honest about that. Some other animals, we'll have a bond with humans, but one of our things in when we work with animals in any captive situation, we try not to have that sort of bond with them, because it can sometimes play on their minds or your mind on decision making, etc. But in a nutshell, Susan, giraffes, I have often gone back there. I see a giraffe back at the zoo that I'm back at now that I saw born 26 years ago, which was an incredible thing to see that she was still there. And yeah, she doesn't recognize me. Lovely. Thanks for your question. Thanks for your question, Susan. Right, I think we're going to just go back down now, and I think Jandre and I have decided we need a bit of a Karula fix. So we've let her be for a while, and it's going to see if she's maybe moved position or gone up into a tree or whatever. We get a few better pictures of maybe her and the cubs, obviously respecting her always. But let's cross back over to James and see what he's up to, and I'm sure he's up to something, Mr. Hendry.
I'm going to walk there. Hello, everybody. Two things. Just two things so far. Two. No animals. Hey, Brian?
No.
Rather desolate.
Yeah.
At the moment. Yeah, I'm sorry about that.
It's not a good time.
No. But I did find a flower on the Natal Gwari, and the last time I smelt it, it smelt very delicious. And it seemed, they seem to have lost their scent already. Anyway, you can see the flowers. They are flowering, the Natal Gwari, so there's a sign of the coming season. Then, too close, I'm so sorry, Brian. Let's put it there. There we are. It's going to blow away now. I'll hold it. There you can see those very indistinct, sort of greenish-yellow flowers that used to have a nice smell, but they don't smell of anything at the moment. Then, what I'm going to try and do, but I'm pretty sure I'm going to fail, is get... There are some flowers on the knobthorn over there. The reason I'm going to fail is because climbing a knobthorn tree will result in severe flesh wounds from the thorns. But I'm just wondering if there isn't a flower that maybe have dropped down. So let's go and have a look. Knobthorn, no flowers, some flowers. You can hear me, can you, Brian? And they're not obvious to see unless you kind of quite close. So you're quite silhouetted, so you won't see them. But they smell so nice. I'm going to be able to get one, I'm afraid. Unless one is falling. Walk backwards. You can hear me now, can you? Very special to be able to smell them, everyone. But I think we'll have to wait for one lowered to the ground to flower first. And then the flowers, of course, will be devoured by various animals. And that's why you've got to find them quite quickly. The reason I have to walk backwards is that my battery pack with the microphone in it is attached to my backside. And therefore, the aerial cannot face away from Brian, or you lose us. There we are. Okay, on we go. Turn around here, we don't want to go back up that way. Alrighty, on we go. A couple of other guys going to look for those lions now. Maybe they'll have some luck and then we'll go back there. If we get very lucky. Very artistic, Brian. New feeling? Yes. Stunning. Hello, Manda and Michael. I'm going to assume that you are two people, Manda and Michael. And you want to know about the Pell's Fishing Isle. You say you've become Safari Live addicts. Well, then we like you very much indeed. We're very glad that you're Safari Live addicts. We too are Safari Live addicts by default. And the Pell's Fishing Isle, you will find... let me quickly show you a picture of it. The Pell's Fishing Isle is very unusual. It's not going to be seen here because there are no flowing rivers. It must have a flowing river to live above. There are very few records, but there are some records of the Pell's Fishing Isle in the Kruger National Park on the major rivers. And even in the Sabi Sand, down on the Sand River, I know that there have been one or two sightings of Pell's Fishing Isle. And the Pell's Fishing Isle is this owl here. See him there. He's quite an unusual fellow, and he sits above the water at night like that. And then he jumps down into the water and catches fishies with his claws, with his talons. He's quite a severe looking fellow, isn't he, Brian? Very sinister. Very. Oh. Bum, bum, bum. Brian, do you think we'll see a mammal today?
Hope so.
I do too. Although it would be something of a Safari Live record to achieve a 3-hour drive without seeing a mammal actually on the property where we are supposed to be. I suppose we have seen warthog and impala. The Nyala wasn't on Juma though. No, we can't count him. No. And I'm pretty sure this has got a lot to do with these distribution of grazing and browsing at the moment. Hello, James Richard. On the subject of owls, you're wondering about the pink eyelids on the Verroes eagle owl and what sort of evolutionary purpose they might serve. Now, that is an interesting question for you to have asked at this juncture of my current of my existence. I've just been reading a book. It wasn't on evolution specifically, but it made quite a lot of mention of evolution and how there are a number of functions in the body that more and more we think are perhaps, and this is in the bodies of all animals and indeed in the characteristics, that perhaps don't necessarily serve an evolutionary function. It's a lovely shot there of a lilac-breasted roller. And, James Richard, I don't know that the pink eyelids of the giant eagle owl aren't perhaps one of those things. So if you think about how evolution works, it's a random genetic mutation. So, for example, I used the example the other day, last night, while I was explaining something, that when human beings became upright walkers, the pelvis had to shift. So there was a random genetic mutation and a human being was born one day, this is a very simplistic way of putting it, with the hip around, you know, sort of tilted. Not that the hips, the pelvis tilted. And that gave that human being the ability to walk upright, and he then left more offspring because it was a successful strategy of existence, in a nutshell. Now, it is equally possible that, for example, a human being could have been born with 6 fingers. And that wouldn't necessarily have been a particularly useful adaptation, but it wouldn't have been a harmful adaptation either. Now, you do get those kinds of things. How's that? Yeah, I'm back. You get those kind of adaptations, everybody, where A characteristic will come into a population and it will kind of drift because it doesn't have a negative or necessarily positive effect. Now, I'm of the opinion, as are many evolutionary biologists, that that is very uncommon. So why would the giant eagle owl have pink eyelids, and why would all giant eagle owls have pink eyelids? The answer is I don't know. I have no idea. But to say that it could be some kind of mate recognition technique, it might be some way for them to see each other in the darkness where they close their eyes and there's just slightly more reflection and so they recognize each other in the darkness. It might be something like that. I don't think it is to do with sexual attraction because both male and female have them, so I'm not sure. But I take the point from the book that I was reading that you've got to be careful of assigning some kind of evolutionary adaptation to absolutely every characteristic of every species you find, because sometimes they just ain't there. I'm not sure about the pink eyelids though. Let's go down Mumba Road, Brian. You like Mumba Road, don't you? It's not bad.
Yeah.
Maybe there'll be a mammal here. Or a bird. I'd take a bird, wouldn't you? I'd take an invertebrate at this stage. We did find a butterfly, everybody, but Brian wasn't able to track it with his camera because it would have made you nauseous. Not so, Brian. You did. Just give an impression of what it would have looked like. Yeah, now you see, that's just going to make them more sort of motion sick of you. Slightly nauseous. You get that dreadful feeling and you're driving along thinking something must pop up, surely. Yeah, we've spoken about worry bushes, spoken about marula trees. Hello, Jean. You say, which plant or flower did I describe as smelling like chocolate? Do you remember it? Do you remember what plant it was?
Might have been the foxglove.
It was, yes, it was. It was the foxglove. It was the wild foxglove. It's exactly right. Thank you very much, Jean. I'd completely forgotten until Brian reminded me, and now I remember where it was, too. It was on Impala Road. Thank you. Yes, it was the wild foxglove, Jean. Which we won't find now because it's winter and very dry. Oh, very well remembered. I'm slightly distressed. I couldn't remember exactly which one it was. Yes, like sort of boiling chocolate. Ooh, it's a rather nice thought right now. All right, come on, we must be able to find something of great importance and interest here. I'm also just slightly worried that I've told you a lie about these marula trees because I've been trying to sex them. You should be able to tell the males from the females by looking at the branches. But they're all starting to look rather similar. I will just roll gently down this hill. Oh, here we go, hang on. One second, everyone. We'll just quickly have a look here, and then I'll hand you back to Hayden. I don't think his current viewing position is going to go anywhere. And let's just have a quick look at this tropical tent web spider. Now, this is one of the few invertebrates that survives the winter time, and they maintain their webs in the most astonishing fashion. And I think there's a little egg sac in the middle here. Can you see that white thing, Brian? There's a tiny little white thing about 2 millimeters across, and I think that's the egg sac of the tropical tent web spider. And the little spider itself is the tiny little coppery thing to the right of the egg sac. Can you see it? In fact, she's actually sitting on top of it. It's a minute spider, everyone. It's probably only about a millimeter across. Just incredible. And the lattice work, utterly amazing. Okay, well, from a female tropical tent web spider with her egg sac and her soon-to-be little spiderlings, let's go across to the great queen of Juma and her little leopardlings.
Well, not straight to the queen of Juma, just to let you know that, just for the record, because James is referring to me as the Duke of Sydney, and I don't know where it's come from, but I'm certainly not the Queen of Juma. We just got here, and we had this magnificent shot. I just moved in this location. She was sitting right in the middle of that frame just there. And wonderful Kirsty, the director today, said to me, "We're going to come to you. Beautiful, looks fantastic." And was just counting me in from James, and the Queen of Juma disappeared. She's gone back down there. So what we are going to do is probably just remaneuver ourselves again. And you know what? Coming to Africa is not a holiday. You got to work for it. You got to put a bit of work into this, haven't you? It's all about putting the work in to see these beautiful creatures. So I'm going to... What should I do here? I'm going to just try and edge up a little bit. See if we've got another vehicle here with us. Of course, it's all about sharing this beautiful sighting with other people and giving as many people as we possibly can a shared experience. She's just down there. But again, I'm going to get Jean-Dre into that poor position where he's got to shoot through. It's going to be really tricky for him, but he's going to slide around now. And you tell me when, mate. Is that a little bit further forward, folks? Just stand by for me. Okay. That's probably the best we're going to get at this point. Just because she is where she is and we can't really do much more about that. So she's now having a bit more of a feed. Jean-Dre, you just tell me if you want me to go further forward a bit, mate, or...
Maybe
it's... Just a sneeze like another 6 inches, doesn't it? Just further forward, and let's just see how we go about there. Right. It's not brilliant, folks, but it is Karula, and in shot, and feeding, and it doesn't get much better than... seeing a leopard, at any leopard, but particularly this beautiful, beautiful female. And she's definitely making good work of that that kill. So she's had this for 24 hours nearly. More than 24 hours, I think, Jean-Dre, yeah?
Yep.
And as they go through the different tissue, that they go for the most nutritious organs first, and she would have eaten those before she went and got the cubs, and then she'll bring the cubs back, and it's normally the easiest areas for them. And then she's been crunching through bones and eating away, and they'll have full bellies, because you don't know when a predator's going to come through and just either stumble upon this or pick up the scent as the carcass becomes more or starts to degrade. It starts to let off a lot more odor. We've got a great question from Cindy in Tennessee. Cindy, you'll want to know whether Karula would hoist that up the tree. And do you know what? I am not sure to say the reason for that. I believe that that carcass would be a great decoy for her to allow a predator to take away that or push her off, and the predator would obviously go for the scraps there or whatever they've got, particularly if it was hyena, the rest of that. And she would have an opportunity to get away with her cubs, or her cubs would allow to get or hide her cubs, and then her decoy away again. Look, each scenario that happens, Cindy, you can't predict, but I don't know whether she would have the time. She may decide to. They may have had enough. She may hedge her bets and say, look, my cubs and my full belly is good enough. Either she'd let it go. I'm not really sure. But at the same time, there is a tree. There is a chance that she could hoist it up this tree directly in front of us. So hopefully that doesn't happen. But if she does decide to do it, we'll probably be standing right by here anyway. So let's go across to James quickly. I think he's got something very, very beautiful to show you. And we will try and get into another better position. See you now.
Pity for you. Pity for you. Pity for you. That, everybody, is the same brown-hooded kingfisher that Eggsy and I found here the other day. He's just flown off exactly the same branch into the same tree. And I wonder if he doesn't have a little nest here, he or she. Look at the lovely colour, iridescent there. And see a bit of blue and green. And exactly in the same way that the starlings don't have the pigments of blue and green. That's a trick of the light, played by crystals of keratin and melanin and air gaps in the middle between them that absorb all the other wavelengths of light and just reflect the green and the blue. Isn't that lovely? So no green pigment there, no green or blue pigment. As you can see him eyeing us very carefully. Thinks we haven't seen him. Ha ha ha. But he's probably slightly afraid that we have. That's why he's turned round, so that he can fly away quickly. Now, on my screen, his colour looks quite green, but then when I look up and I actually look at the bird sitting on the branch, it's quite turquoise. And it's that colour that gives them their name, the Halcyon Kingfishers. That's Halcyon Blue. That's actually quite special because he's very close by. He's probably only about, 10 metres away from the front of the car, Brian?
Yeah.
There we go. Look at him there. Come on, give us a call. He really is a special bird. And all around you might be able to hear the wind rustling in the trees above. We're in the Mluamati drainage line at the moment. And so it's quite sheltered where we are, but the wind is rustling through the tops of the trees. There he is. As soon as we move, I'm pretty sure he's going to fly off. So let's just get a little bit of a view of him while we stopped here, and then I'll try and sneak forward and see. We can't get a side-on view of him. All right, let's move a little bit closer and see if he sits still. No, there he goes. I'm watching him. Ooh, now we'll get a really nice shot, everybody. He's sitting out in the open now. Brian, I'm just going to try and get us past this branch here, and hopefully he will stay seated. Ooh, that's beautiful. Wonderful. I might even try and take a rank average photograph. Excited, Brian?
I'm very excited.
Deeply. I'm afraid not even this lens is long enough for a shot like this there. He's about 3 pixels big. Very nice. Valerie in Pennsylvania. Nice one for you, from you, about olfactory senses and whether birds have olfactory senses. Absolutely they do, Valerie. They're a massively important part of how their senses, especially for birds like storks, Storks use their olfactory senses extensively. So do the New World vultures. So like the condors and those sorts of animals, they use their olfactory or nasal senses very much. I don't sure if a kingfisher does. I'm sure it can smell various things, and I'm sure that there are elements of its physiology where it will use its olfactory senses to sense the pheromones of other kingfishers. But most certainly, they have very good noses. Should we try one more little sneak forward, Brian? I mean, I know that's a full frame shot for you, but I've only got 2 pixels on my screen. Oh! He's gone. You see where he went? Now you've got to have a really long lens if you want to do bird photography. Because the birds don't often let you get very close. No, I think he's gone. Now, the reason we came down the mighty drainage at the moment is because... Oh, there he is again. Sorry, everyone. Is simply because we... he's gone. Is because we smelt a mustable elephant down here and we thought maybe we'd find him. While we have a look for him, let's go back to the Queen with the Duke.
Well, James is being very, very kind to me. He's given me a title, which is more than most other people have given me. We moved into a better position here. I kind of like this framing, what Gendre's done here with this picture, because it looks like we're hiding behind some vegetation. Obviously, we all know that she knows that we're here and so on, but I love it when we have that sort of framed up like Gendre's done there, like we're peering through the undergrowth, spying on her, but doing it in a very, very nice way because we're just so fond of this creature. We've got a question from Paul that's just come through about can we smell a dead impala? We did. I got a bit of a whiff of it earlier this morning when we were on the first drive, the morning drive this today. And it was, look, it's not a smell that's hard to deal with, Paul, at the moment, that's for sure. But as time goes on and the tissue of the animal starts to degrade, you will start to get more of an aroma flowing through. And with this wind at the moment, it could carry it definitely to someone else. And that could end up in the kill being stolen. But who knows? Who knows? But the most important thing is that she's getting a feed now and really, really relishing in those bones that she's chowing on. We can hear them cracking from here. Incredibly powerful jaws, and pound for pound probably one of the strongest carnivores in Africa. Not necessarily bite, but pound for pound in its whole muscularity and its physical ability. So she's enjoying that immensely. And then we still tried to locate the cubs. They're probably holed up under the bank where we're sort of sitting in a nice little spot in view of their mum. And just to where Gendre's moved around to the right, we're sitting right on the edge of a sort of dry creek bed or drainage line, we call them, where when the rains do come, water runs down here into twin dams. But it's really nice to just be sitting here with her. We've been so fortunate, folks, to be with her for this amount of time. But she is that famous leopard that allows us to, and tolerates us. We don't ever overstep the mark with her. T- Tiffany's just asked whether the vultures come and finish the rest after the leopards move on. And you know what, Tiffany? I'm not sure if they'd actually see it. It's a little bit of cover here. Vultures are quite incredible, but look at the vegetation up there. That's the wonderful shot there. Gendre has just given us this sort of little canopy here, and there's a couple of different trees here that are overhanging. They haven't got much foliage on them. There's a bit of scrubby brush down there. It's sort of in a bit of a gully. If a hyena dragged it out and pulled it up there, they might, but I don't think there's going to be much left by that time. And I don't think they probably will. So, great question. Thank you for joining us. And let's see how much. She is definitely getting her fill. She's going to be lying down with a very, very full belly after this. And she's really enjoying that. So Karula is 12 years of age. We'll talk a little bit more about the ages of breeding and everything when we come back. We're going to go across to James, because he's got a creature that we don't often get a chance to shoot pictures of very often, because they don't stick around for very long. Let's see what he's up to.
Now, we came into this area a few days ago and we found exactly the same little scene playing out. Some monkeys, this time staring into the now golden light. Now, I was describing the light earlier today, and you can see how it is much changed from when we began. It's now much more golden than it was. It's not that sort of very harsh sort of midday dry season light. It's softening just beautifully, and that monkey is in a perfect spot for sundowners. He's got jackalberry fruits to eat, he's got safety, he's got a magnificent view, and he's got the rest of his troop around him in the tree eating on the unripe as yet jackalberry fruits. Brilliant. Righty. They don't seem to be doing much else there. There are also some, sounds like some alarm calling birds in here, but it might be there's the elephant. You just hear it going, ah! Did you hear that, Brian? Would you like to give an impression of what it did? It did, that's exactly what it did. There's some alarm calling birds in there, helmet shrikes, but I think if it was anything that we wanted to see, I think the monkeys would be going ballistic rather than just staring longingly into the setting sun. Let's go along and see if we can find the elephant that went, ah! Maybe we'll find out why he went, ah! That is wonderful. Put my hat on properly. This is a gale force wind now. Brian, I tasted some jackalberries the other day. They were not delicious. In fact, they were disgusting.
Every time it was, that's
great. Yes, that's also true. Something to do with the lack of water. Elephants were around here. I can smell potato bush, everyone. And whenever you find the potato bush and you pick a piece and you think, oh, well, this is going to smell like potatoes, it never does. It's almost got the air's almost sort of got to be away from them for them to smell nice. Very scraggly, funny bush. Right, let's go and have a quick look there. And then we're going to make our way back slowly towards the lions and hope that they maybe pop out as it gets a little cooler. The other thing to just quickly mention, of course, oh, there are the elephants. Aubrey, just go again with that position. Aubrey says he can hear impala alarm calling around where the lions were. Okay, copy. No, that's not for the lions. That's a wonderful shot, isn't it, Brian?
It's amazing.
It really is a stunning, stunning sighting of two elephants. I'm sorry about this area. We're not allowed to drive off-road for them at the moment because of the drought. We'll go round to Ledwood Road, which is not far from here. Maybe we'll get a bit of a view of them there. But what I was saying is that, you know, normally this time of the day, if we weren't really doing anything else, we'd wander off to the hyena den and see what they were doing. And it is with great consternation that I must report that we still have no idea where our hyena dens, or our hyena clan's den is, where they've gone to, why they've gone, and if they'll ever be back again. And we had that sighting the other day of the hyenas eating the... eating that buffalo, and I think we all agree that that wasn't our hyenas, probably the hyenas of Arethusa. Okay, let's go back to Hayden and Karula. I will attempt to get into the sighting of the elephants.
So we're still with Karula folks, and another vehicle has just turned up. It's absolutely fine. They're just getting a nice position to watch Karula. She's completely relaxed. And she's still feasting on this impala that she took down yesterday morning. And her cubs have feasted on as well. James is going to go off and find those elephants for us. And we're just going to sit with Karula for a little bit longer. Excuse me. Connor, who is 6 years of age. Connor, welcome aboard, buddy. It is so great to have you with us. Really, really wonderful. I'm sounding a little bit blocked up, Connor, because I've got a lot of dust in my nose at the moment, so apologies for me sniffling. Connor, how wonderful to have you on board, mate. That is the most brilliant, brilliant news to know that you're watching Safari Live at the moment. And you don't want to know what is the biggest... Just correct me if I'm wrong, Control. Was it the biggest animal a leopard can bring down? That's what Connor wants to know. Okay, Connor, I'm sorry. I wasn't sure if it's the smallest or the biggest. You said the biggest animal. Well, you know what, Connor? Normally it'll be animals like the size of an impala, which is probably, depending on the size of the impala, probably twice the leopard's body weight, roughly. So maybe about 150 kilograms. Now, I don't know where you are, Connor, what part of the world, but it's the metric version, roughly double that for pounds. But I've actually seen Connor pictures. She's just gotten up. She's just looking around a little bit. And she's just out of shot. Poor Gendre's got a branch just sitting in the way there. She's going to drag this now. Now, I wonder if she's going to take this up the tree. Connor, please just bear with me for a second, mate. Let's just see if she is. She's looking up that tree. This could be absolutely amazing. I think she has sensed that it is time to move this carcass, the remnants of it. Whether she's had enough and is going to cache it up the tree and then move on and come back and have another feast on it, or what, I'm not sure, but she's definitely picked up some information that made her a little bit nervous a second ago. And it's always that wonderful leopard look when they grab onto their carcass, they look up at that tree, and you know what the next few things or few moments are going to happen. It's a bit of an ascent, that's for sure, because she's down in that drainage line already. So she's going to have to drag it up there. She's looking at a few different trees at the moment and deciding on which one to put it in. Interesting. She's assessing the situation. Looking up, potentially deciding on where to take it. Here she goes. It's dragging it up through here. I think she's decided on this tree in front of us here. This is going to be spectacular. We've just got a bit of a broken view between us and her, the vegetation, but I don't dare move at the moment. I don't want to disturb her. We have a tambuti tree in front of us that I think she's chosen. She's looking up. She's still deciding. I think the youngsters are coming along. So we're just deciding where she goes. Taking it by the back of the neck, watch this. This is where a leopard is the absolute superbly designed power and strength. Assessing where to put it. How clever. Looking at the best location. Because one thing she wants to do is just use the momentum as she starts to ascend and make sure she puts that in a good location in the tree. Here she goes. Oh, fantastic. Come on. Look at that power. Absolutely unbelievable. It wasn't the most graceful of ascents, I have to say, but nonetheless, and it was an ascent, and I couldn't do it. So she definitely has made the right decision. She's going up a little bit higher and she's going to stick it right there. That's a go. I'm just going to move up a little bit for Jandre because she's committed now, she's fine. She's up in a very thick part of the tree there. What's that like for you, mate? What an amazing leopard. It wasn't the most easy of ascents, that's for sure. It's a very tricky tree where she is. It's definitely not leaning, it's vertical, and it's also got a lot of scrubby old branches up there she had to deal with, but she's wedged it in, and there's not going to be a lot of animals other than another leopard that'll be able to get that. You can see her panting now. So we'll just sit here with her for a little bit longer because that was great to see, and I'm very excited that we actually were present when that occurred. We're going to cross over to James and see what he's up to with those giant beasts. We'll be back with you just now.
We did manage to find them, everybody. We came just around the corner and there was a little herd of elephant. There is Mum. That's a young cow. She's got a calf somewhere in the bushes here. And she is mangling that acacia tree. She's eating the bark off it very skillfully. Amazing the dexterity with which she's squashing the bits that she wants between her trunk and her tusks, and then eating only those little pieces of the tree that she wants to eat. It's an astounding thing to watch. You have been watching, of course, something deeply jealous-making, that of the great queen hoisting her meat into a tree. Oh, what a wonderful thing to be seeing. But look how she's very daintily and carefully picked the bark off, the bits that she wants to eat, and the rest she's left. It's so clever. And it does make you wonder, you know, we spend a lot of time with that cow who's only got two-thirds of her trunk left, and she doesn't have that prehensile tip like this one's got. It does make you wonder how on earth she copes, how she managed to compensate, given the dexterity with which we were watching this cow eating the bark off that tree. I'm seriously tempted to go towards her and try and pick some of that bark, but I'm not going to do that because that will result in my getting flattened. Not so.
Yeah.
Yes. Let's just move a little bit further forward. There we go. Oh, very pretty, Brian. Invisible, but pretty. I might try and take a picture, Brian. Hello, Aaron in Florida. Nice question from you about whether or not elephants or an elephant cow might reject her baby after birth, and what would then happen? Would it be adopted by another cow or perhaps not? Aaron, it's most likely what would happen is that, well, it's highly unlikely that a cow would reject her baby, but an orphaned cow, we know an orphaned elephant will almost certainly be adopted by others or lactating female within the herd. I've just not heard of a situation where an elephant cow has rejected her baby at birth. I suspect it has happened, and I suspect most likely if there's a lactating female in the herd, she would absolutely adopt it. Elephants are well known for adopting the weak, sick and infirm. Unlike most other creatures out here, lions especially. If you're left alone or rejected as a lion cub, well, good luck. Likewise, hyena. All right, let's go straight back to Hayden and his incredible leopard sighting.
Well, folks, I'm really, really sorry, but I've shrunk Karula. 1 minute I looked, she was big, and now she's tiny. Folks, you wouldn't believe this. Karula just went down, and one of the cubs has just ascended the tree to where his mum has put the carcass. And this is a great learning tool. I'm going to reposition ourselves so we can see the cub. It's a great way to teach those cubs how to climb, how to get up there, how to feast, how to get all their skills that they're going to need in their life. And train them how to deal with it. Absolutely phenomenal mother. And it was literally put the kill up the tree, I'm just going to reposition a bit for Gendre. It's really tricky. He's got a lot of vegetation in front of him there. Just let you move back a bit, mate. There we go. And I'm so sorry. Maybe you can help me and tell me whether this is which little individual this is, whether it's the male or the female. But okay, so I think it may be, is it Hosanna? Okay. Okay, so that's fantastic. It is. It's Hosanna. So it was just beautiful. This is like poetry to watch. An incredible leopard, a 12-year-old leopard that's a very successful mother, has had great success with her cubs, has 2 7-month-old cubs. We have witnessed her teaching these cubs exactly what they need to survive. She ascended. Chandra and I weren't sure whether she heard something, because she did become very alert. And we thought she heard something and she was going to hoist it up. Now, it could be coincidentally the same time that she heard something that she's just decided it was time to get this kill up the tree. So she hoisted it up. She ascended it. As I said, it wasn't as graceful as many others that I've seen, but hey-ho, she's got it up there, and much better than any of us could do. Got it up there, descended the tree, has gone over to where the kill was, and she seems to be, it's very difficult for us to see from where we are, and I don't really want to take the camera off the vision, beautiful pictures that we've got, but just to let you know, she's back down where the kill was. I'm not sure whether she's covering up some of the scent or what she's doing at the moment. I don't think she is. I think there's a couple of tidbits, little tidbits of food or scraps down there that she might be chowing on, a bone or something like that. But what she's done then is put it up, and sure enough, Hosanna, her 7-month-old youngster, stood at the bottom of the tree, stretched his claws a little bit, and up he went. And he ascended that tree, and now he's up there feasting. So what we've just, all of us this afternoon, have just been to leopard school. And what a joy it has been to be at leopard school today with these beautiful creatures. Lesson one, how to put your kill into a tree and go up and eat it. Watch how it's done, son. Love it. Just love it. We just got a lovely question from Lucy to ask what's my favourite leopard since I've been working through here. Lucy, look, it's a very, very simple, straight-up answer for me. It's one of Karula's offspring. He's a male. His name's Q, or Mr. Q, or his name was, it was quite a bit of a boring name. Not boring, but a name. It was Quarantine was his name. It didn't quite fit. He used to be seen on the Quarantine area up the top a lot, and that's where he got the name, the Quarantine Male. So I don't know, we've shortened it to Mr. Q, but he's a super leopard, and he was the first leopard I saw when I came here in 2014. And you know, the team that works on Safari Live year round see loads of different leopards, and I'm just incredibly privileged to see whoever I see when I'm back here. Karula is the leopardess that I just absolutely love to bits, for all different reasons. But Q, Mr. Q, is definitely one of my favourites. He's a young male, he's up and coming, he's sort of seen in the area now and again. Oops, mama. That wasn't me. He's looking at mama. It wasn't me. I didn't do that. So mum's just looked around and she's like, actually, I think it's still pretty good. It's pretty wedged in there. He's like coming down now going, I didn't do anything. I didn't touch it. It's like a naughty little kid, you know, going into into a jar on a top shelf and knocking some of the things down on the way up. Incredible, incredible pictures. But wow, we've been to leopard school. I don't think there's many people around other than all of us on the vehicle today that's going to be able to say that tonight. Well, that was just great. Fantastic stuff. I was just so chuffed that we saw that, and to see little Shoshana go up there as well. I'm really, really, really excited that we witnessed that, and we were lucky to be here, and now we're still watching, and we'll stay here for a little bit longer and see what happens. And we're just going to cross over to the wonderful James Hendry and see what he's up to. We'll see you just now.
Everybody, we've found some kudus, as you can see, and they are pretty impressive and could possibly be the kudu known as, Brian?
Zeus. Zeus the mighty kudu.
Zeus the mighty kudu. But Zeus the mighty kudu is not looking around here, so you can't see the impressiveness of his horns. But off to the left of him, there's another mighty kudu. With not quite Zeus-like horns, but close. And then to the right of him, a much lighter coloured one. There we are. So, quite possibly Zeus and his two cohorts. I wonder what they're looking at. He's probably just sort of posing for the camera, don't you think, Brian? He's a rather magnificent fellow. And the kudu do not, by sort of default, stand still for this length of time next to the vehicle. So we're quite lucky that they're doing that. They look almost sort of statuesque, as if the camera has frozen them. Listening to the wind, smelling. There we go. His cohort to the right definitely doesn't have nearly as impressive horns as he does. There we go. Look at that great spread. I don't know if this is Zeus, everybody. I think half the time we call Zeus, it's we're probably at 10 or 12 kudu around here that are known as Zeus. But he's a magnificent specimen. He's also quite dark. You see that? Isn't that nice? And you can there see the difference between their two horns. I don't believe that that makes a difference to their breeding success or their ability to fight with each other. The sort of, I guess the importance attached to the spread of the horns, the width from tip to tip, was actually garnered from the hunters, who of course think it's arbitrarily have assigned a value to the width that the horns are from each other, and that's, you know, if you want to shoot a kudu, that's basically how you decide which kudu to shoot, by the width of its horns. Now, a more random and ridiculous sort of variable to have assigned to value on a kudu I couldn't possibly think of. But anyway, there it is. We are human beings, I suppose, and we are prone to the odd, really gormless bit of behaviour. Right, back to the leopards with Hayden.
Well, we have stayed in this same position, folks, just for the simple reason Hosanna is just up there feeding away on that carcass. He nearly drops it out of the tree, and he successfully looked a little bit like he was in a bit of trouble. And now we're going to see him descend. So we've come back at a perfect time here. Look at this. So this is a young leopard learning exactly the skills he's going to need as he grows up to survive, negotiating this perfectly with such, even at 7 months, look at that, using his body to work his way down. Absolutely beautiful. Such a privilege, folks, to be in the presence of these creatures. Look at you. He is a little dude. He's such a dude. He's like, right, what do I do now? Okay, I'll just lie here for a minute. No, I'm going to go down backwards. Yep. Oh, phew. Was anyone watching that? Okay, cool. I'm cool. Everyone's cool. Such a great leopard. such a beautiful creature. And you know what? His mum was over there before. I just copped a little bit of a sneak through the trees of Kurula covering up the scent of where this leopard was. Where the kill was. So we really did have a great sequence of things happening. Now, you know what's happening right now? It's Shongile, and I'm not sure if I'm pronouncing that exactly right, but I'm having a bit of a go at it. And she's at the base of the tree now. And look, she's going to go up and have her turn. How extraordinary is this? This is just magic. Now, we have definitely been to leopard school. How magical. One little guy goes up, comes down, it's your turn, up you go. This is how it's done. A little bit of trepidation there. Just got a bit of vegetation there that we have got right in Jandre's shot, but she's going to come through and up and around, so we haven't moved. I think Jandre's going to have a lovely little location there for you, and just in a second, Shongile is going to come into shot. We've got a question from AJ, and AJ's 7 years of age. AJ, what a brilliant question to ask, mate. You want to know whether the mum teaches the cubs how to climb trees. Well, you know what? There's an instinctive thing in all animals that they do have the ability to do certain things that they're designed for. So what I mean by that is they would naturally want to try and climb trees, but what she has done, she has actually put that rest of that meal or that food up in that tree to teach the leopards, her young leopards, how to get up there and deal with dinner in the tree, so to speak. So your question basically is, does the mum teach the young ones how to climb a tree? In this particular case, absolutely, AJ. She's put the kill up the tree, and the cubs are now going up into that tree to learn how to deal with a kill in a tree and feast up there. So we are very, very fortunate, AJ, to see this. And it is an absolute honour to be sitting here watching these two little cubs in leopard school. And it's what a wonderful afternoon. So I just talked a little bit about it. She decided, I'm not sure. She's right behind that bit of foliage there. I don't dare. Jandre's done an amazing job this afternoon to try and capture this. We've been in the most vegetated area, and now Shongile has just gone down. Oh, there we go. We've got a tail, Jandre. That is a leopard tail, folks. What do you think, mate? Do you think I can just casually go back? I think she'll be okay. She's going to move. She's a little bit restless. She might decide to go down, actually, and this could be leopard school descent lesson 2. Sniff a leaf on the way down to make it look really cool that no one's watching. Sniff around and think about how to get down gracefully. I'm a leopard, for goodness sake. This is so cool. Just have a little sniff over here. Okay. We've all been in that position before, haven't we? Stuck. Up the tree, not really sure where to go. But it's all that learning process, folks. It's that learning process of strengthening themselves, developing their skills, looking how to negotiate situations. And she's doing exactly now. She's turned herself around. Very clever. Clever girl. Really clever. And She's around the back of the tree and she's down. Very hard to see, folks. It's a tricky spot for poor Gendre, but... Oh, wow, that was brilliant, guys. So, you know what we're going to do? We're just going to just go back to James. We're going to try and reposition and get a little bit more of a picture, and we'll come back to you just now.
Sweet Lord. Right, there we go, everybody. The sun is about to set in a blazing ball of hydrogen bomb explosions there, forming helium. The helium is fusing to form other elements, and it is all combining to produce a rather stunning orange glow behind those trees. Isn't that pretty? I knew the sun wouldn't let us down, Brian. The lions let us down very badly, but the sun did not. Ever faithful. We can for now. Perhaps in a billion years, well, then it might explode and then it won't be very nice at all. But if it doesn't explode,
I think at that stage we'll be cursing the sun.
I think so, yes. Sometimes I think we're mad, Brian, don't you?
Most days.
I'm sure when we have conversations like this, people think we are mad. Yes, indeed. Quite. We're going to head back now, everybody, to see if we can find the lions up to the north of the reserve. I'm sorry, I've gone stark raving insane. What happens? This stony silence from the final control. Monique, you're in London and you say, what do I mean by the term sundowner, and is it another term for sunset drive? Absolutely not, Monique. A sundowner is a very specific thing. It is the first tipple or snifter that you have at the end of a day while watching the sun go down. So if you have a sundowner, it is your first drink after a hard day's slog in the bush while you watch the sun go down. That's a sundowner. And it is to be consumed preferably from a high point in Africa watching the sun, or indeed you can have one at the sea. Sundowners at the sea are very good. What is your sundowner of choice, Brian?
I would say the sea.
The sea. You like to drink the sea for the sundowner.
I do like to drink the sea.
I see. That's even madder than I thought you were. Okay, well, it's a good level of madness. Like I say, we're going to head up back towards Sydney's Dam, see if those lions don't pop out. I thought maybe I was just being incompetent this afternoon, which I may have been, but Mike and Ephraim went back there. They were with the lions this morning. They couldn't find them again. So I don't think that they were where they were left this morning. We might be lucky. There's something else of vital importance I wanted to tell you, but I've forgotten what it was now. Anyway, delightful temperature, but I think it's going to be quite cloudy tomorrow if I look at this front sort of blowing gently in. And the lack of mammals continues to assail us. It's so interesting, and I wonder, well, I mean, I'm pretty sure that the concentration of animals has got everything to do with the fact that we've got such concentrated food, and so animals are more and more moving in huge groups, and so an area like this will be devoid of them for a week or two, and they'll come back in, and they'll move out again. Anyway. We'll see what happens as we go. Wonderful that we've had the whole afternoon with those leopards. I'm just going to postulate that I think Hayden's probably going to have to leave almost immediately, given that the sun has gone down. And those cubs, of course, we can't view after dark. There are some impala, Brian, our second impala sighting of the day. Our cup runneth over, as it were. Oh, very nice. I like that tilting impala sighting. Looked like there were mountain goats for a little while there.
Does what one can.
One does. Yes, and the colours again continue to astound me. I was chatting to somebody yesterday, and she said to me, you know, I really find it difficult when I come out here, and she's English, I find it difficult when I come out here and look out into the bush at this time of the year. It's so harsh. And then she said, but there's a feeling, there's some kind of feeling that really gets into your bones, and wow, despite the fact that that might look like a harsh view, it really does have a sense of, I don't know, profundity about it, perhaps? Not sure. I love this time of year because of the expectation of the coming new season. He's also got ominous eyes. You see that, Brian? Just a bit like that that rather scary owl we showed them a picture of earlier. Mmm. Ooh.
So terrifying.
Ooh. And eating bits of grass, some dry leaves. They're picking up leaves as well, of course. The impala, very clever. They're able to eat both. I'm just trying to see signs of pregnancy amongst the females. She's probably a bit young. I don't think she's pregnant. There actually, I've failed to see too many ewes who are obviously pregnant. So maybe a couple of weeks still before they start to show, obviously. And they're all, you see how they've fluffed up their backs? They've fluffed up the fur there. And that's a result of the chilly breeze blowing out of the southeast. Hello. The little fly sitting on her nose there, staying warm. You think that's a fly, Brian, or do you think it's a nick? I think it's a nick, everybody. Either that or it's a mountain climbing fly. All right, let's move on. Let's go towards Aubrey's Road, see if we can't pick up those lions. Not that hopeful, but we might be lucky. All right, we're going to go back to Hayden. He's going to have to leave the leopards pretty soon.
So, folks, we just wanted to finish up with this beautiful picture of Content Karula. She did have the cubs next to her a second ago, but they both ran off and played, and as they felt still for very long. She's done an amazing job this afternoon, and we have been to leopard school. We really have. It has just been such an honour to sit with her and see her teach those cubs how to feast up a tree, how Mum does it, and does it like the only cat really in the world that can do anything like that, and hoist an impala carcass up a tree. So it's been, oh, hang on, here comes one of the cubs. Here comes one of the cubs. Look at this. Onto Mum. What a beautiful finish. What a beautiful finish. And that's why this leopard is so incredible. Leopards themselves are incredible. They're just beautiful. What a beautiful thing to finish on. But we are going to leave them in the safety of their mum now and move on. And as the afternoon shadows have lengthened and the sun has gone down, we are now going to leave them be and say thank you, thank you, thank you to those beautiful creatures for letting us be with them all that time. Wow. I'm a little speechless, and doesn't happen very often with HT. Poor Jandre's been sitting on a crazy angle for about the last hour. He's been squawked like this, and if he needs to, do you need to make any adjustments, mate? You're okay. You're good. Poor Jandre's been on this angle of like this for about the last hour and a bit. So hats off to him for pulling that together and getting us those pictures. But AJ, I'm so sorry, buddy. I got cut off halfway about your question about what's the largest prey that a leopard could take down. And look, AJ, there's lots of books say different things. There's been pictures of leopard bringing down wildebeest that are about 300 pounds. Pardon me. 300 pounds, which is about, in kilograms, anyone that's watching, is about 140, I think, at a bit of a guess. Jondre's nodding at me, giving me reaffirmation there of my calculations in the old head of mine. So they can pull down those animals. I think I got my kilos and pounds mixed up before when I said to you about the impala weighing what it was. I thought about what I said and I was like, no, an impala doesn't weigh that. An impala weighs probably about 75 kilograms, which is about, I don't know, 300 pounds roughly, or a bit under. And sorry, did I get that right? No, 150 pounds, roughly. Trying to do the maths here, conversions. So they can haul an impala up a tree, about 150 pounds, pull down probably twice that. But here's the bit that I wanted to tell you, AJ. And AJ, I've seen pictures of this. I didn't see it happen live or in the park I was in, but I've seen a picture of a leopard, taking down a young giraffe. And that young giraffe wasn't a baby, wasn't a newborn. It was actually probably a 1 or 2 year old. And the leopard was actually on the giraffe's neck. And that leopard's body weight, sometimes a big male leopard could get up to 90 kilograms, which is about my body weight. But anyway, we don't have to go on about that any more than we have to, okay? Okay, 90 kilograms. Yeah, I need to lose a bit, right. But the body weight was just pulling that giraffe down, and that was in Kruger National Park, and it's quite a famous photograph. So, AJ, great question. I'm so glad you're watching, mate. 6 years old. Goodness me. Brilliant. We've got a little zebra over here as well. And I'm just going to... I think James has got zebra as well. Has James got zebra? Okay, you know what? James has got zebra, and he's probably got zebra better than we've got, because our zebra are over in some vegetation there. Let's cross over to James and see what his zebra are like. It's been so wonderful to be with those leopards, guys. We'll be back with you just now. We're going to scratch around and see what else we can find before we close.
Our zebra have now gone into vegetation as well, everybody. But there they are, just to prove that we did find some mammals. Well done, Brian.
Well done.
Brian was so excited he fell off the car. I had to pick him up and put him back onto the car. Anyway, that's them. Some days the universe doth spit upon one, and some days it doth bless one richly. Well, nice to see the effect of the stripes, I suppose, through the thinning vegetation. Now, we met Ephraim. Ephraim has done a twist around this block looking for the lions, hasn't found them, reckons they're still in here, quite a thick block. We're going to go up to the gate and see if we can't find them popping out. Perhaps they're getting mobile towards Sydney's dam. Perhaps we will see just blowing wind and leaves tumbling. It is very thick in there, so it's quite difficult to get in. But we wouldn't just go blundering in there unless we kind of knew where the lions were. I'm going to keep an eye on the road to see if their tracks don't cross. And there you can look too, everybody. Please keep an eye out there. If you see the lions, let me know immediately. Some tracks going in here, but those are very old. I think that must have been another sighting. Not of lions, of vehicles. And while you're looking there, just observe the number of broken trees there are. Astounding number of broken trees as a result of the elephants eating all of the knobthorns. It's mostly knobthorn and cambretum as well, but knobthorn ostensibly. Now a very clever question from Jennifer, Gracie's mum. Hello, Jennifer. Thank you for your question. You want to know about poisonous thorns. Are there any? I think they're probably thorns that cause allergic reactions in different people, depending on how sensitive you are. So we have, well, there's a plant called strychnos, which you've heard me mention probably very many times, or the black monkey orange. And the black monkey orange has got a substance in it, a strychnine, that can affect some people's skins. And Eugene, who used to work with us, he got cut once by a little, I mean, really very seemingly innocuous cut on his skin, and that it bled, or didn't, it festered into a kind of noxious wound that we had to have bandaged, and I think he actually even had to have a little bit of it cut away. So that's an example of a poisonous spine, if you like. They're not strictly a thorn. Then you get a group of plants called the russes or the caries, and the caries, definitely there are a few of them. If you get nicked by their thorns, you can get swelling, you can get itching, but there's nothing that's particularly dire. Nothing is going to cause you too much harm. We're just going past the gate here. This is the Sabi Sand gate. The anti-poaching unit, or some of the anti-poaching unit, lives over there. Thank you, Brian. And we'll turn some lights on now and see what we can see down at the dam. Those lines are in here somewhere, but like I say, it's really thick. And you, oh, Illies. Wonderful, they're coming towards us. They're not running away, Brian. Yes, yes, yes. I'm so excited to have animals not running away from us. Maybe they'll find the lions for us. If elephants find the lions, they will make a very large noise. They'll go, what will they do, Brian? Exactly. That's exactly what they will do. Brian's not joking. That's what they will do if they see the lions. I can just see the eyes rolling in the final control. They're the elephants, everybody. Just going to stop here and let them cross the road. Isn't that nice? Nice, huge herd of them going off into the block. I think that's the matriarch coming into view now. Her eyes slightly more sunken than the others, which means she's older. And she's also that much bigger. Nice, you can't even hear them. Just hear the soft sounds of their feet on the sand. You hear that? This rough hide against vegetation. Right, let's go a little bit forward. I think they're going to come out into the clearings here, which will be very nice. Might well start to feed them. They also might step on some lions. It's also very thick in there. Let's go around here. We can't go off-road for them, but there's quite a nice clearing up ahead that I think they might come into. Just looking, scanning the dam, but there ain't nothing to see there. There's a hippopotamus there lurking in there, but not much else. Well, probably the odd terrapin. But Brian, I don't think we can stop for terrapins at this stage. You know why? They're also they're not nocturnal. No. Yeah. I'm being completely facetious, everybody. If we found a terrapin at night, we could definitely view it. So the elephants are walking along here. This is actually great for our lion hunt, to be honest. It's not great for our elephant viewing, but that's kind of the line that we'd like to have a look at. But we couldn't drive through there. We certainly don't want to walk through there in this light looking for lions. So we're going to go to the apex of the road here and then turn and see if they don't come out into these clearings. And if we hear them yelling, then we'll try and make our way in there. Fortunately, they do seem to be going into the thickets. It's very trying of them. Very trying, Brian. It's very trying. Okay, let's stop here and have a look. And we might be able to hear them moving, but I'm afraid they've gone into some thick bush. But But the sky is very pretty. Thank you, Kirsten, for your words of encouragement. There they are. Wonderful sighting. That's our second best sighting of the day, Brian. Look at them there. Stunning. Ooh, got a glimpse of a tusk there. That was special. Still, it does remain a very, very beautiful evening. Oh, look at that. That's not to be sneezed at, Brian. It's not to be sneezed at, I tell you what. Okay, let's pop around the corner. I don't think they're going to come out here. I think they may well pop out at Sandy Patch Junction, the main road there, where your tail axis. And I think it could be quite nice around there. So we'll head around there. We'll also just have a listen for those lions. And while we do that, let's go back across to Hayden and get an update from him.
Well, beautiful elephants, eh? Magic. It just keeps giving. South Africa, you just keep giving. You're amazing. We love you. Just incredible. It's been a fantastic afternoon. I am absolutely over the moon. I'm like a little kid inside. We went to leopard school together, everyone, tonight. That was brilliant. And Karula. Wow, wow, wow. We're just going to go down to this little pan just below Voyatella, or above the dam, where there's a permanent water source. We'll just see what's in there. Potentially there might be a couple of ellies, maybe, I don't know, something else drinking. Excuse me, please. I just want to clarify a couple of things what we're talking about weights, because people get a bit funny about weights and what the books say and all that sort of thing. So a leopard roughly can take up about this 1.5 times their body weight up a tree, depending on how big the animal is. Jandre and I were just discussing after we crossed over to James. Jandre said the Anderson male has been seen to take down young giraffe as well. So AJ, this is all stemmed from your question. 6 years old. What a brilliant question, mate. So I'm just wanted to clarify a few things. They can pull down animals much larger, but taking up the tree is about 1.5 times their body weight. And look, there's always going to be exceptions to the rule. There's always going to be exceptions to the books, and there's always going to be these anomalies or these strange facts that you read. And I love that about nature, because there's always going to be a bigger and stronger one somewhere around that does some incredible feat. But wow, what a creature. What a creature. We don't have any action here at the moment, but we'll just go over and look a little bit closer, because sometimes as you just pull up to the waterhole or the pan, you do see elephants walking down or some other creature walking down. We've got a lovely question from Karen in London. I'm just going to turn around here just to sit for a second. The wind is quite extreme, so I'm just trying to get my mic out of the wind a little bit. We might even drive and talk, Karen, as it's a very exposed little spot here. Yeah, nothing coming. Karen, as I drive, we'll talk about your answer or your question. Thank you for coming on board, and lovely to know that you're in London watching this. My old second home city, 16 years I spent there, and do miss the old London town. Karen, just let me get out of this wind, get down onto this bank, going across the dam wall here. We might just protect ourselves a little bit from this wind, because I know it's going to be tricky to hear. Karen, you're interested to know what rhinoceros program I was working on many years ago in Zimbabwe. I first started out in 1992 working on a program that was, there was a decision to translocate some rhinoceros from Zimbabwe back to Australia to have a a breeding or a genetic breeding pool in Australia at that time, and so that we did, and that was a very big project in 1992. After that I went back there and I worked in some areas in the Lowveld on some projects, and that was a very interesting and incredible time for me to learn a lot about rhino down there as well. So a lot of time I spent in Zimbabwe. I've got a very, very big passion for rhino, and obviously we've got some tricky, very tricky situations going on in the world with rhino, the five different species. I take my hat off to anyone, you know, supporting any of the rhino programs going on in the world. It's definitely something that is worth investigating more, everyone. And if you do go, there's great organizations working closely with conservation with rhino in Africa and Asia as well. Don't forget the three Asian species as well, Sumatran, Javan, and Greater Indian or One-Horned, and very, very important as well. Thank you for coming on board, Karen, and welcome, welcome if it's your first time, or if not, welcome back. Gorgeous colour in the sky. And Karen, I do apologise, you are a regular viewer, and great to have you back. And it's a pleasure to be here, so thank you very much for asking the question. So a little bit quiet on the front now, but I'm still on a bit of a high, Jandre, aren't you, from that leopard school 101. Look up in the index. Boyd, you're asking a very good question. What makes Karula's, what characteristics make her so recognisable? Well, I don't have a picture with me now, but if we do see her tomorrow, I'll ask Jandre to focus in tight on it. Not only is she stunningly beautiful, which all the leopards are, she has some very distinct markings on her forehead which resemble the word wow. Just hold on, it's a bit bumpy here, folks. I apologize. Yeah, so she's got wow, very distinct markings. W over one sort of eyebrow there, or eye area. W over here, and a O in the middle, and it looks like wow. And she is wow. So on that wow of a note, let's go back to a wow of a character, Mr. James Hendry.
We did find the lions. No, those are not lions. What are those things called again, Brian?
Elephants.
Elephants, well done. Those are elephants. They came across the road. They didn't have any lions running fast in front of them, and they're now on their way to Arethusa. They're about to cross the sort of main road between us and Simbambili, sorry, not Arethusa. And that's where they're going to spend the night, obviously. There's a nice dam there, but I think they've... Oh, that's an elephant. Here are some more, coming just across the road. I just saw movement and I assumed it must be a lion, but it isn't. There's obviously young bulls, but that's, I mean, that's a small elephant to be trailing a herd that size and not close to it. I wonder if there aren't a few more adults coming through as well. That was a nice surprise. I saw the movement and immediately assumed it was a lion, but it wasn't. Ooh. Hang on a second. You hear them shouting there, everyone? Now, these ones don't look vaguely alarmed. So if the others, I think, if they'd spotted lions, for example, they'd have rumbled as well, and these ones would have been warned off. I think that was probably just a youngster that was very cross. And these ones are just now, you can see they're not alarmed at all. They're just walking towards the herd. Now, I can see them in my monitor. I'm hoping you can see them as well. I know they're dark, but we won't put any light on them. And just to keep you posted, Mvula is actually on Biffle's hook. He's very relaxed there. Unfortunately, we can't go there. But of course, if you were to come to Juma, you could go and see them there. Alrighty, that's our elephant sighting, I'm afraid. I'm going to turn around and head for home now, everybody. Lions might pop out. I'm going to think they probably won't, though. Shall we use the spotlight, Brian?
Yes.
Yes, that will be exciting. Some bright lights in front. There we go. There we are. I haven't seen the Hayden Turner spotlight technique. Everyone has a different spotlighting technique, in case you're a new viewer. Mine, not the most effective. The best one I've ever seen, of course, being the Jamie Patterson, and we need to do it at least sort of once every 2 weeks or so. This is the Jamie Patterson spotlighting technique, which I've no doubt is extremely effective, but you really have to have the shoulders of a rower to be able to do this for any length of time. Now, Jamie Patterson, of course, does not have the shoulders of the rower, but how she manages to maintain this, I couldn't imagine. Sorry, Kirsten, you're going to have to say that again. I missed you. Oh, this is exciting. Thank you, everybody, for joining us today. I know that we didn't find a great deal, but we had a great deal of fun with you, so thank you for coming. Thank you, Brian.
Thank you.
Well done. Good job. And we'll hand you back to Hayden, who's got a really special thing to show you.
Well, folks, I just thought it'd be a bit of fun, and you know I like my gadgets, to bring along a bat detector. Now, a bat detector, you might not have ever heard of before, but it's a very, very cool piece of machinery that allows us to detect bats and the echolocation of bats. The bats that we just saw here a second ago are insectivorous bats or microbats, and they use echolocation as their way of seeing their landscape. They send up out high frequency, much higher than our human audible, much higher than is audible to our human ear, and sends it back, and look, here we go, listen to this. Wait for it. Did you hear that? How cool is that? So what this machine is... That is so good. Oh, I just love it. So what we're doing is we're picking up that high frequency. It's about 40 to 50 kilohertz. That is way higher than our ear can hear. And this machine has taken it inside. I'll just turn it down a little bit. It's taken it inside the machine, processed it, mixed it with another frequency, and turned it into a frequency that is audible to our human ear. And that is what that bat is using, echolocation, to hunt with. It's hunting, and I just wanted to do that because I think some of the things we overlook in our life, we see bats. We're going to talk a bit more about bats over the next few days. There's about two or three species, that I know occur here, that I talked to Yuri Moorman, the expert on everything, earlier today. And I just thought this would be a really cool thing to have a play with at dusk. But wow, it's such a cool sound. So there's a bit of static there, but listen, that is a high frequency. If I turn that off, you can't even hear that, but the rubbing of my fingers is a high frequency. So this is processing the bat's echolocation. Anyway, I'm going to leave that off for the minute. We did hear it, which was brilliant. I'm really excited about that. I love my gadgets. I love technology and wildlife. It's brilliant stuff. I just wanted to thank you, say farewell to you for tonight's drive. It's been an absolute pleasure to be here. I'm so excited to be back. It's a short time for me, but I tell you what, it spurs me on, and it gives me such great joy to be back here with you, having you and experiencing what you did today. I also want to thank the incredible team behind this, as I always do, because we, sitting in this driver's seat, have it easy. We've just got to talk and tell some stories and enjoy it and show our excitement and enthusiasm. There's a massive team behind this, and the other person or people that we can't do it without is you guys. And that's what Safari Live's all about. These animals are here. Karula, we love you. You guys, thank you very, very much for being with us this afternoon. We'll see you in the morning. Thank you for watching Safari Live.